She wants to continue. Navajo Kuro, Kuro Chief, Kuro Chief, friend.
I just got the correct pronunciation.
There's only 2,400 of them left on the planet. You're kidding?
Wow.
No.
Wow.
People have been killing them off, so they're beautiful sheep.
Mm. Why are they killing them?
I don't know.
With Mangelic, baby, eat them, baby.
Yeah. So they'll all be out at the ranch, living in a barn, by the way, that's nicer than the house I grew up in.
There
so.
Yeah.
And some of them will get to spend a little time, I guess, personally with you, right, friend?
Well, it's just a matter of protecting the sheep, you know. That's what it's about. Yeah. Got coyotes out here. You can't leave a sheep down in the barn at night. It's cold, you know.
Yeah, absolutely. That big old woolly sheep.
Even though I do have music piped into their barn.
We actually put curtains in the sheep barn, you know.
Oh, yeah, those
are. Have you got the curtains yet?
I don't know. That's
And the curtains have coyotes on them, you know.
Keep sheep in line.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Just my brother's going to pick some football games. You were right about the World Series, Fred. Congratulations.
Well, that was an easy pick. Yeah, and the only thing is, you know, I wish it had gone on longer. Just makes a more enjoyable time of year.
You're going to rerun that roast on Saturday. Well, you already saw it, right?
I saw it. It's great. Okay.
All right, let's pick your game.
All the senators were good. You know, I wouldn't say one was much better than the other.
Kerry was great.
Kerry, I mean, he was great, but I thought all of them were good. Even Domenici was good.
Now you would think Domenici would be pretty much out of it. But
yeah, but he seemed to pull himself together, you know.
Boy, I had game the other night.
There you go.
Yeah.
Who are you picking in these games, Sunday, friend?
You want me to read them off, or you want to review?
You read them off.
Oh, okay. I got Washington over the Bears.
Okay, Redskins over the Bears.
Giants over Philadelphia.
Giants over Philadelphia.
Rams over Tennessee.
That's going to be a great game.
That is?
Yeah, the Rams and the Titans.
Yes, it is going to be a good game.
That game's in Nashville.
In Nashville.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I have the Bills over the Ravens.
Okay. You're picking all favorites, by the way.
I can't help it, you know. It's just the way they fall.
Got to pick what's going to win,
I mean, and, you know, I could be wrong. This is the toughest week, by the way,
because
of picking games.
Because most of the games suck. Who do you like?
No, actually, there's some pretty good games.
Who else do you like?
I like the Browns over the Saints.
But the Browns will win their first game.
Right.
Saints are favored by 9.5 points.
Okay, well, I can't help that.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Kansas City over San Diego.
Okay, well, Kansas City favored by 6 there.
Really?
Yeah.
I got Denver over Minnesota. I bet they're not favored there.
No, they aren't.
No, they're not.
Minnesota favored by 2.5.
They're playing home, Minnesota?
No, they're in Denver.
Of the Raiders over Miami?
Well, there's no line on that game.
No line on it. See, it could go either way.
Coin flip. Yeah.
And I have my last game is the Cowboys over the Colts.
Mm-hmm. Colts are favored by 3. That game's in Indianapolis.
It'll be a good game. Cowboys are bouncing back. You know, they had a little letdown there a couple weeks ago, but they're coming back.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Is there a car race this week, Chuck?
Don't know. I haven't looked. I'll look.
Do you know, Fred?
I don't know. I think there is. They race next week in Phoenix, you know.
My man Dale Earnhardt's cleaning up there, Fred.
I know. He's...
You know what happened? He won last week. You know how that happened? All the other drivers fell asleep.
No. He's got that Richard Childress behind
him. Happened was the Earnhardt raced on Saturday and the race was on Sunday.
That Richard Childress is too good, man. He's too good.
Yeah, you know, that one in Phoenix is one you could actually go to, you know, in this part of the country because the others are so far, you know, scattered around. I don't have any tickets, but if I did, I could go, you know.
Well, the NASCAR people love you, Fred. You could go hang out with the drivers if you have an open invitation to go to any of that stuff.
I do?
Yeah.
Yeah, I wouldn't mind going down to Phoenix and seeing that race. That's a great race down there, by the way.
Fred, you should have come up to New York for this Yankee game the other night. I was there as a guest sitting in the Legends of Baseball right on third base there, Fred.
Right behind the Braves dugout.
And what do you call it? Hanoi Jane was in back of me with Ted and all that kind of stuff there. And we goatated that third baseman over there, that Chipper Jones, where he actually was grabbing his crotch and making motions at me.
Uh-huh.
And then he was giving me the finger. And I says, excuse me, Mr. Chipper Jones, you're supposed to be a professional athlete. I said, you better stay out of Hooters without them this indiscriminations that you have with them side orders. You know what I'm saying? So Chipper there, all he kept doing after every one, I don't know if he had an itch or something, but he was grabbing his crotchitation. And it was very, very serious there. But
some redneck meathead.
Great seats. And then I had Paul Anka with me. We had the Unilever box, the luxury box up there.
There was a booster seat for Paul Anka?
No. The luxury box up in the Unilever. And we were going back and forth to our seats to the Unilever box. What a great, great night. But the only bad part about the night is when all my fellow officers came on the field, it looked like they wanted a riot to happen. They had so many cops. And then the commissioner walked around, thought it was General Patton there, saluting the troops.
No.
Kept walking around and around and around. But I tell you, what the feeling in that stadium that night was great. I ended up in the lanes, then I had to see pucatacious Bob Costas. He's a friggin' midget, that guy. He makes me look like a tower inferno. Lupica was licking up the bar there, and it was good. And my man Jack Nicholson ain't making a move without me from now on. Mm-hmm. And we had a great time. Mike the Russian, Joey Pots and Pans, we were all at Elaine's.
Lupica tells me that he was at Elaine's, and here's Bo Dietl with Jack Nicholson. And why do you have Joey with you?
No, Joey's my man. He only stays awake until a certain time, then he falls out, and they carry him out of the place because he's sleepy.
Tell the people that Dwayne Reed needs a lot of gum. So
yeah, well, Dwayne Reed's our guy. But what? Lupica saw me over there.
All right, here's Fred's picks now for this weekend. The Giants over the Eagles, yep. Bills over the Ravens, the Cowboys over the Colts, Chiefs over the Chargers, the Browns to win their first game, even though the Saints are favored by 9.5, Rams over the Titans, that could be a great game. Redskins over the Bears, the Raiders over the Dolphins, that could be a good game as well. And the Broncos and Vikings could be a good game. Fred is at 58% so far this year, which is not great.
No. A little disappointing.
So.
But still winning.
In fact, that almost sucks, Fred.
Yeah.
It does. Well, I think I'm as good as the rest of them.
No, you're not.
It's like you're over 60.
No, you need to be over 60%.
I do.
Yeah.
So. I could be over 60 after this week.
No, yeah. We'll see.
You know, because I got into it a little bit more this week, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, I picked him about 10 minutes ago.
It's 28 after. I love you. I'll call you later.
I love you, bye.
My brother's appearance sponsored by Jeep.
Yeah. Love them Rams. You know what, Don? They covered, since the beginning of the year, they covered the spread, no matter how big it is. The Rams have been covering. I'm going to tell you something. I guarantee you they'll cover this week.
They covered a 19-point spread last week.
I know. Hey, today I'm going to be at the parade. After I leave here, I got to go down and parade. Inside Edition has me down at the parade. You know what they have me doing?
No.
Last year, they gathered up all this just stuff they're throwing out the windows.
Yeah.
You got to see some of the stuff. They're not even shredding the stuff. They're throwing people's accounts out there with their home addresses, account numbers. So I go through the garbage there that gets thrown out of the window, and I show them all this proprietary information that's being thrown out of these windows. You know, some of these corporations there better realize it's kind of serious, some of the stuff that they're throwing out. People are throwing whole papers out with account numbers, addresses, telephone numbers.
Jeez.
Where you can put billing on, American Express card numbers I found on there with their account number, the name. So we're doing a little gig of what goes out the windows during a ticket tape parade.
Cool.
Bo Dietl goes to the movies coming up. It's 29 after the arm.
Frankenstein was the first in line, and the Wolfman came up next. Dracula was a doing his stuff, a breathing down my neck. Jump back, make tracks, here comes the hunchback, better get out of his way.
Hey, Mikey, how are you going to celebrate the millennium?
I thought I'd go out.
Hard questions, hot issues.
The fiery debate over gun control.
Every angle of today's top stories. Crosstalk NBC. Today, 3 Eastern on MSNBC. News at work becoming a little impersonal? Log on to MSNBC.com and personalize our homepage to track your local news, weather, sports, and business news. The stories that affect your hometown delivered right to your office. Hey, it could keep you out of a jam. Log on and work smarter with MSNBC.com. You hear a lot of talk in prime time, but at One News Network, it's a different story.
Ready to defibrillate.
Stories that teach, excite, and move you on Special Edition with Ann Curry.
Oh, my.
The day's biggest stories on the news with Brian Williams. And stories about the people who change our world. Headliners Stars and Legends with Matt Lauer. Prime time on MSNBC. It's a different story.
I'm a mall Santa, and it's a little slow this year, but I have prospects.
Get a watch today here, Santa wife.
Hey, where are you going? Hey, hey.
You can't dwell on what was, really.
We were the king. Don't forget that, okay?
I don't blame the malls. It's not their fault people don't shop there.
Skip the mall. Go to shopnow.com. It's the shortest distance between you and the stuff you want.
I wake up every morning, I look at myself in the mirror, and I go, it's a good day to be Santa.
One place on earth where all these worlds collide. Introducing Salon.com, the 24/7 web network for news, entertainment, and ideas. Salon.com.
Stuart, can I see you in my office, please?
That kid is sick.
That hinge is going to be very sick.
Stuart, get in here.
Sure thing, Mr. P.
Stuart, I just opened my Ameritrade account.
Let's light this candle.
Let's go to Ameritrade.com.
It's easier than falling in love.
What do you feel like buying today, Mr. P?
Kmart.
So research it. All this stuff is provided for you free of charge.
No cost.
Yeah, that's synonymous with free.
Looks like a good stock.
Let's buy.
Let's buy 100 shares.
All right, click it in there.
Okay.
How about 500?
100, Stuart.
You feel the excitement? You're about to buy a stock online.
Oh, fabulous. I'm thrilled. What did that cost me?
$8, my
$8.
Man.
$8.
$8. Riding the wave of the future, my man.
I gotta get a soda.
All right.
I'm sorry, Mr. P. I'm having a party on Saturday night if you really want to go.
I'm gonna try and get there.
Happy
Thank you,
trading.
Stuart. Thank you.
Rock on.
All right, Stuart.
Call toll free 1-888-590-8009. Ameritrade. Believe in yourself.
Good morning, I'm Chris Jansing.
And I'm Greg Jarrett. We're going to be getting back to Imus in just a moment, but we have a very busy morning to tell you about. The trial of a 13-year-old set to begin in a little over an hour in Michigan. He's being tried as an adult for murder, so we'll have opening statements when that happens.
Also this morning, a big scare in Cleveland. Now, police there say a group of students has been planning an attack on teachers and students, and they were planning to end it all with a suicidal showdown with police. School has been canceled, and we'll have the latest at the top of the hour.
And we'll also have live coverage following Morning Line today of the memorial service for golfer Payne Stewart. That's at 11 a.m. Eastern time.
And then later on, the Yankees ticker tape parade and the latest for Halloween. Join us at the top of the hour for Morning Line.
We'll see you then.
Bo Deedle. Good morning, Mr. Deedle.
Good morning. How good is this? We finally did the deal with Mr. Ted Waite there with Gateway Computers.
Yeah.
They're going to be putting our product. They have a product on there like a block or a filter on already, but this just complements it for the parents. And like we were talking about the last time.
I've become a convert to One Tough Computer Cop, by the way.
Really?
I'll tell you why, because Bo's absolutely right. It's great, particularly if you have a company, you want to know what people are doing. Like we had a guy, we had an engineer here doing porno stuff on a computer, and if we'd have somebody just go around on a company computer. And if we'd had somebody go around and just stick a computer cop disc in there, and it reads back to you what people are looking at on the computer. And, you know, I used to interpret it as spying on your kids, but that's actually not the case. It's your kids get sucked into stuff, or maybe you do, not just kids. It's not just, you know, kids are smart as adults are, and in some cases smarter. So, you know, it's a way to, it's a good monitoring device. I'm sorry I was reluctant to endorse this thing initially.
Thank you very much.
You idiot.
You and Gateway. Gateway's jumping on with all their millions of computers. You know, like we talked about when we were flying down to Washington, one of the things of I always say is, you know, if there's a kid on there talking to his friend about committing suicide, that he's depressed or something like that, and a parent picks that up, man, then you could get the kid some help.
That's
if you
point.
Save one kid out there, then this whole thing, this is not a nonsense thing, man. But let me tell you something. Gateway loves it, Don. Gateway loves it.
Oh, what are you
making a good
save
point.
Save one kid. He wants to get another Mercedes.
No.
It is a good product.
And I just want to give the our toll-free number time out there. It's 1-800-311-3114. It's 1-800-311-3114. And believe me, if you really can tell and you can monitor what your kids are doing on the internet, it's very good.
Point.
And you know you have one ready for little Wyatt there. We got a very nice one for his computer. Computers are good. Yeah. I got a little guy. I got little Bo, 5 years old. He's on a computer. And you got to see all the crap that comes in automatically on the email. And, I mean, you as a parent have to know if your kid's getting involved with these violent groups. You got these neo-Nazi creeps on the air and all that. No. And it's just a great product. I'm great to be part of it. And Computer Concepts is a great company on Long Island. And thank you very much for that, Mr. Iman.
So Bo was out at the – I talked to Trump yesterday, by the way.
Yeah, he's going to be – I tell you what, I don't know if he's really running, but I tell you, he would make a great candidate.
I said to him, don't tell me because I don't want to know. Not that he would tell me, either on or off the record. But whether you like Trump or not is irrelevant. The guy – and whether he's jerking our chain is also irrelevant. He's saying a bunch of stuff that people agree with that other people won't say. One of them, we should bomb North Korea. We should – and these other countries – we should put a stop to that, and we should. And this deal with Japan and these other countries, we should renegotiate those deals. I mean, that's absurd. Do you know that you cannot sell an American car in Japan?
It's ridiculous.
How outrageous is that? Why should we put up with that? I mean, it's ridiculous.
We got all this gook crap coming
That'll
in,
be fine,
but we got nothing going out.
So, but I have a feeling that Trump is.
You missed the dinner the other night with Warren Buffett, partner. Warren Buffett. Me and Warren were hanging the other night with the great Richard Santulli. And I tell you, you got to listen to what this guy says. You know, he's very actively involved with Coca-Cola and with Dairy Queen, McDonald's stock. This
I
guy,
like Buffett, and I love Santulli.
We love Richie Santulli.
Yeah,
I tell you,
good
executive
guy.
Jet. Excuse me. We
Eat
do
me, Bernard. You spalled it. Dope.
The giant
let me explain. I have a giant sucking
sound
for
your
moron
studio.
Face. And, we happen to like Santulli. What about it?
Yeah, Warren Buffett. All the rich, all the rich white guys.
Warren
Buffett.
I like Robert Johnson, a guy from BET, too.
Let's hammer people here. Come on.
How about hammering you?
I like LL Cool J, and I like Puff Daddy, man. Come on now.
Yeah, right. Came to your house.
But what a great dinner he had. All the CEOs, you know. I tell you, it was
so. Bo's out at the baseball game. And I mean, interrupt him, but Trump and some other people sitting right behind the Braves dugout, saying to Chipper Jones, "Why don't you go to Hooters and see your son?" And
great,
because Chipper Jones, while he was married, this redneck dirtbag, goes over and Bernard's right. You can't be knocking up the waitresses at Hooters or anybody else for that matter.
Waiting
but
for your entree.
You're waiting for you to have lunch. You know, for God's sake.
Yo.
I mean, come on. So. It annoyed Chipper to the point that he was actually flipping, grabbing his crotch and flipping Bo the bone.
Yeah.
Bo had his jacket off, and Chipper, I guess, saw your gun and changed his mind about coming into the
Chipper
stands.
Chipper didn't want no part about
no.
it. I had my boy sitting there, and I even had my man Paul Anka there, one of the great songwriters, who gave
midget.
Me all his music, including My Way, for that new movie, Table One.
Yeah.
His whole
Why don't you
library.
Bring Paul Anka in here some morning so we can slap him around?
No, he wanted
sure.
to come in. I'll
some
bring him in. I'll tell you what.
We have a booster seat for him.
Oh,
we'll
I'll
play catch with him.
I'll bring him in here, and I'm going to tell you something.
We have a little dwarf tossing in here.
You're very, very mean.
Well,
but,
we know Paul Anka is one of the great songwriters ever. Well, I mean, that's not in dispute here.
Fine.
But, I mean, after that, let's move on.
No, but, I mean, he's
trying to, by the way, write something else here. It's been a while.
He's been writing. I tell you what.
I mean, the last thing was Having My Baby. That's been about 20 years ago.
No. He's got the new album out, Live 2000.
Yeah, I know. It's just dreadful.
No, it's not dreadful. It's a great album.
Oh,
and he'll be appearing in Atlantic City in a couple weeks. Why don't you come with me?
Great.
I'll take you to see him.
You couldn't. The money doesn't exist on this planet to get me to go to a casino and see Paul Anka.
Nah, I tell you what.
Or Elvis, for that matter.
I'm going to bring him in here one morning, and you'll see him, and you'll see what kind of a guy he is. He happens to be very
I'm sure he's a nice guy.
He's got beautiful daughters. He's got five daughters.
I'm sure he's a lovely guy, aren't you? I'm sure he's a great guy.
He's a great family man, the whole deal.
We don't have any problem with Paul Anka, but I mean, get over him.
You probably accepted payola for one of his managers years back playing, Diana and all that, no?
No, I refused to. I even refused to take. I was taking drugs mostly. I refused to take drugs or money to play Paul Anka's record. It was a little before my time, so I did break a few Stones records and Eagles records, but somebody had to play them.
Boy, last night was a big premiere. Last night I went to the big premiere last night.
What movie? Now here's
All right, but please,
it's time now for it is time. Bo Dietl goes to the movies.
Yeah.
But we have a
caveat
here.
Confrontation.
No, you cannot review any movies that you have any financial interest in.
I have no financial interest in this movie, I swear to you.
Aren't you an executive producer of this movie or a producer of some sort?
I am an associate producer. What I helped them do was make the reality about this movie with a lot of the aspects. I brought crime scene unit guys in there. I took Denzel Washington to meet the kid McDonald who was paralyzed.
Yes.
I also brought the director there. I brought him and showed how
For no money.
No money, so help me God.
Do you have any points in a film?
Not a point, and that's why I'm an associate.
Do you stand to make anything from this movie?
Not at all.
Nothing.
I swear to you,
zero.
My children,
zero. You will not realize any.
Well, if something comes out of my involvement eventually, there's no money involved.
No material, goods, nothing.
Nope.
You've received no money, nothing.
I received an associate producership for the movie. I did, because I wanted Marty Bregman wanted the movie realistic. We brought actual crime scene guys in there.
Marty Bregman, by the way, is a dope by the way.
Queen Latifah going to clean your house?
Made some of the great movies. If I could talk, leave Queen Latifah alone.
It's time to make a new one.
But listen, let me tell you something. This is a movie that was based on a book, The Bone Collector.
Why did you do this for nothing? You don't do anything for nothing.
You know why I did it for nothing? My relationship with Marty Bregman. He asked me to do it, and then he gave me this associate producership thing, and I'm very proud about this movie.
Bring him in here, too, so we can slap him around.
Well, let me tell you who's in the movie, first of all. Sure, Denzel Washington, Angelina Jolie, she played Gia.
Right.
You have Michael Rooker, Michael McGlone, Ed O'Neill from Married with Children. No. Queen Latifah's in it, and Louis Guzman. Now, this movie's based on this fella who's a crime scene unit guy. That's Denzel Washington. He goes into this tunnel that was set up, and all of a sudden he gets his back broken in half. He's a quadriplegic. And it goes, and it's very authentic, very authentic. Christopher Reeve was there with us last night. And then he's out of it. He wants to kill himself. Now this young girl, Angelina Jolie,
comes on
the scene of a homicide with a hand reaching out.
And the ceiling will fall in.
But what happens is this guy who's committing all these murders is leaving evidence, and you've learned each murder, they kidnap a little kid, they kidnap this couple.
You're telling us too much.
I know, and what happens is he keeps leaving evidence and evidence. I jumped out of my seat three times to help me God with this.
And your arm.
You talk about Silent of the Lambs?
No.
Silent of the Lambs?
Whatever.
This will make that look like lamb shops. This thing was so scary.
Well, here's the thing that's suspect.
Queen Latifah naked?
Here's the thing.
I gave this thing I'm not kidding.
Here's the thing that's suspect about your endorsement of this movie.
Go ahead, please.
You're friends with this shriveled up Hollywood weasel, Marty Bregman.
He's not a shriveled
up. Whatever.
He happens to be Serpico, Dog Day Afternoon, Sea of Love, Scarface.
Dog Day Afternoon, 20 years ago.
Excuse me, Scarface.
Hello?
How about Sea of Love? That was 20 years ago.
Well,
he happens to be one of the greatest filmmakers in Hollywood, and I'm very proud to be associated with him.
Yeah, but I mean, that's the problem. It's there's
association.
My man Joel Siegel was there last night.
Please,
it's got a relationship.
And that guy, that little fruit with the eye makeup, what's his name there? Chris
Rex Reed.
Rex Reed. Yeah, he was swallowing something there too. And I was just one of the main critics.
Why is that necessary?
Because what man puts eye makeup on his eyes unless he's swallowing something?
So what if he is?
So what?
No,
yeah.
Excuse me. They all love the movie. They all love the movie.
Oh, okay.
And you got to understand something. You got a guy like Denzel Washington who lays in a bed as a paraplegic.
You would shoot if you didn't have some interest in this movie.
What?
You'd be doing the chicken wing stuff.
What are you talking about?
Well, you know.
Yeah.
I love Queen Latifah.
You love Queen Latifah. Get out of here.
Please.
What are you, nuts?
What are you talking about? Denzel Washington, the probably one of the greatest actors of all
God.
Time.
Oh, God. You're worse
Oscar
than, you're worse than Al Gore.
I'm going to tell you something.
You know what? Why don't you just squeal like a pig, like Steak Shapiro?
Yeah, ink, ink, ink. But let me tell you something. I guarantee you, as sure as you're sitting here right now, Oscar time for the Bone Collector. You heard it first. Denzel Washington, first, will get the nomination. Angelina Jolie will get a nomination. And the movie will get it's one of the scariest movies I've ever seen in my life.
Make a note of this,
and
Lou.
And then you can say what you want about this one.
Say this tape.
8:44.
I was very, very, very
8:44 Eastern Time, October 29, 1999. Flag the tape.
Yeah.
We'll play this when they announce the Oscars.
Okay, now, when they announce
it,
what will you do when they announce one of these people, if not the movie for Best Picture of the Year? What will you do in return to me? You tell me what you want me to do.
I'll buy you a hair replacement situation.
I don't need no more hair replacement.
Please, you got a sand trap in the back of your head. I mean, come on.
Why do we
got
to go with the hair jokes all of a sudden?
I
got a lot of testosterone. Obviously, your testosterone is a little light. It tastes. You got so much beautiful hair there, you know?
I'll,
What are you going to do?
If Denzel Washington.
You'll give me the iJet. You'll give me the iJet for a trip anywhere I want. And I tell you what, I'll pay for your gas anywhere you want to go with the idea.
Gas. You got to pay for everything. Maintenance,
and
flight time.
And your harassment with them stewardesses on that plane.
Well, I mean, then we're getting it done.
All I can say is you should eat some more of them Sabre Frankfurters, pal. See if you can find where that
My wife's already gone to work.
The Bone Collector, baby, I'm serious. This is the movie.
I got a bone you can collect.
Todd's best picture.
Oh, get out of here.
Did you like Silence of the Lambs? That's baby
no,
play.
No, it's a creepy
That's
movie.
That's baby play. This thing will...
Oh, it's actually pretty good.
The storylines keep going, Don. No, the storylines keep going.
We're out
and
of
it
time.
Brings you along. It's a two-hour movie. You think it's over when it's over?
Queen Latifah.
Queen
Latifah. That's all you have to say.
I mean, now you're Queen Latifah.
Great, great movie.
Get out of here.
This weekend will be the top box office movie, guarantee you.
The Bone Collector.
The Bone Collector. Not this weekend. It's opening up the 5th of November, so it ain't this weekend. The Bone Collector... Election weekend coming up, baby. Number one, it'll gross about $30 million. The Bone Collector. Go see it. You'll scare you. You'll jump out of your skin. Guy cups open your body. Rats go in your eyes and head. Great.
Sponsored by one computer cop. 14 till
Thank you very much.
The God of Hellfire, and I bring you.
I'm a in the morning.
All right, let me talk to you about Nikon now. And this is great news. Nikon has.
Log on to America's Smartest Morning Radio.
Imus in the morning.
Get the newsmakers behind today's headlines now on imus.msnbc.com.
Every weekday morning, Greg Jarrett and Chris Jansing bring you the best of NBC News at just the right time. Morning Line, next on MSNBC.
Jeffrey Dahmer, what made him a killer and a cannibal? A rare look into a profoundly disturbed mind on Special Edition.
Tonight at 8 on MSNBC.
Tonight, they're the traders who make money when you buy stock. See how the secrets of the top market maker could work for you on CNBC's Business Center tonight.
Knit one, purl two.
I want it to be fluffy.
No.
Back off, Jen.
I think you're using my yarn.
Oh, sorry.
Introducing Cozone.com, the place to find computer help and buy what's right for you.
It's a mitten.
Oh.
Cozone.com. We can help.
It's you against him, against her, and who knows who else. All going for the same job. So what's going to set you apart? KForce.com. For the first time, the power of the internet is backed by 2,300 K-Force recruiting specialists to help you break through.
He's the one.
KForce.com. Opportunity has a new address.
Got heartburn up in your chest and throat? Only Gaviscon Liquid forms a soothing, protective barrier that helps keep acid down. Something Maalox and Mylanta can't do. Gaviscon Liquid. It helps keep acid down where it belongs.
When it came to computers, I was so far behind the times, I thought I'd never learn to use one. So when video professor said they could teach me to run a computer in an hour, well, to say the least, I was a bit skeptical. So to prove it, they sent me this free computer CD-ROM. It's simple. You take the CD, put it in the tray, click, and the video starts playing right here on my computer screen. Hey, I'm learning the computer! And so can you. Just give Video Professor a call for your free CD-ROM or video. Choose any of these complete lessons free. Call 1-800-514-9294. Me and computer school? I don't think so. And computer training manuals may as well be written in Greek. I now can use my computer thanks to Video Professor. Call the 800 number for your free computer learning CD-ROM or video. You have nothing to lose. Video Professor makes computer learning simple, fast, free. Why are you waiting? Go ahead. Give him a call.
Now, lower your score, drive longer, hit straighter with Golf Digest. Call now for your risk-free trial issue. If you like it, get 11 more 12 and all for $19.97. Plus this stroke-saving video free. Call 800-391-0707.
No one looks at the markets with a more insightful eye than Barron's, offering timely coverage of stocks, bonds, mutual funds, everything investors need to stay informed. Subscribe now and you'll also receive this Barron's Stock Evaluator free. It lets your computer help you turn money into wealth. Get 13 weeks of Barron's and the Stock Evaluator all for only $39. Call now toll free. 800-952-2626. That's 800-952-2626.
Hey, Vinny, how you doing, man? Is there anything I can get for you?
Well, there are a couple of things.
For the latest in technology, come to The Wiz. We've got the brands you trust at prices you'll love. Like big screen TVs, DVDs, camcorders, and mini systems from Sony, Panasonic, Mitsubishi, RCA, and Fuji.
right, is this enough already?
You forgot batteries.
Oh, the batteries. Oh.
Thanks, pal.
See your authorized BMW center for lease and finance options.
Well, that sticky one.
Let me do that first before winter.
I am Ivan. The morning is 9 minutes till the hour. Well, everybody from Donald Trump to Alan Greenspan are going to be at the Larry King cardiac function dinner at the Four Seasons Hotel on Tuesday night, starring Ricky Martin and his band. About 30 of those folks jumping around. And
yep.
Living that crazy life, baby.
I hear you.
I bought 6 tickets to the dinner at $1,000 a piece, and we gave away 4 of them. I have 2 more to go. And here's Rick from Warsaw, Virginia. Good morning, Rick.
Good morning, I'm in.
How are you?
All right.
You have a tuxedo?
No, but that can be taken care of.
Oh, it can?
Oh, yeah.
Well?
I was thinking about maybe getting a camouflage cummerbund to go with it or something. Stick out a little bit.
Are you one of these militia guys?
No, I'm just a country boy.
Huh? Have you ever had any sort of intimate relationship with a farm animal?
Not that I recall.
Well, you ought to give it a
what
try.
What, are you frigid?
Now, who are you going to take?
My wife.
Well,
she just turned 40 here recently, and I'm going to, give it to her so she doesn't make the celebration.
I bet you are going to give it to her, Rick.
All right now.
Well, guess what?
Yes, sir.
It's a great foundation, great cause, and Larry actually spends the money helping people get heart operations, and they do good work, and he's a pretty good guy, actually.
Well, that's what it's all about.
He donates a lot of his own money, these speaking fees, which he charges about $25,000 to speak, and a lot of the money from the books and stuff he does. So he's doing good stuff, and this is a great dinner, and they're going to raise an enormous amount of money, and you're going to be there.
I appreciate it. We'll represent you the way we should.
Well, that would be like doing what? Stealing silverware, getting drunk, and throwing and peeing in a phone booth.
Right.
Show up in a four-wheel drive pickup truck instead of a limo.
Oh, I love that.
Punch a couple people out.
Yeah. All right, Rick, you and your wife are going. Hang on, Bernie, and get the information for me. Congratulations.
It.
Well, you're welcome.
Thank you.
What's your favorite radio station?
WFAN.
Okay, it's 7 minutes now until the hour.
Yo, I'm in the morning, 2020 sports, fronting the hype, taking a swipe, right with the stereotypes. I think this little dude be sucking on a crack pipe. Want a whoop.
Good morning, Warner.
Good morning. Thank you, I-Man. Well, unless you're a Yankee fan, apparently the rest of the country, forget about it. Nobody wants to see a sweep. The Yankee Braves World Series on NBC recorded the second lowest viewership of all time.
You know why the Costas isn't any good? He's annoying. He's an annoying announcer.
Now, wait a minute. You said he was great the other day.
Yeah, you're all over the place.
Yes,
Costas,
you just did.
Wait a minute.
Jesus. He's doing a good job.
He's good. He's bad. He sucks. He's a little midget. He's a punk. He knows what he's doing. He's a good guy.
I forgot where he was, actually.
You remember?
You know, I like Costas.
I forget what I thought.
Yeah. Wait a minute.
Well, Lupica was telling me. Lupica said he thought he sucks. So, and Lupica's a friend of his. So if Lupica thinks he sucks, well.
Get it.
You mean
no, Lupica didn't say that. I don't think he's very good. He's a posturing little stooge. So,
I think it's the sweep. Nobody, unless you're a Yankee fan, no, forget about it. No sweep, no
right.
Mystery, no viewers.
I'll tell you whether you like him or not. I'll tell you who's great. Al Michaels.
Al Michaels, yeah.
Don't you think?
Very good play-by-play.
I mean, this guy's,
he's
a paranoid whack job, but the guy's good.
But that aside.
Put that aside. Now, I'll tell you else is good is Greg Gumbel.
Greg Gumbel, yeah.
Joe Buck.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Joe Buck.
Carver.
Greg Gumbel never even came up on the scope until he showed up the other day, sucking up to the eye, man.
What a shot.
Never came up. Never, his name was ever even mentioned before.
That is just not true.
He
is
shows
it wrong?
Up one day.
I can't recall it ever.
Right.
I've never heard
you're
of it.
You're an effing liar.
You know, he was a great broadcaster. Was this
no,
great
but he is good.
He showed up and shook your hand and said,
well, you know, wait.
I love your work, guy, man, and now he's a great broadcaster.
That's right.
You are so easy.
Guy's been on 100 years.
You are just...
You're unbelievable. I've always said Greg Gumbel was good.
Right through you.
I've never said anything about Greg Gumbel.
I don't think so.
By the way, is that guy, is the football guy going to be on with you tonight?
No, only Monday nights.
Oh, okay.
John Riggins.
Warner Wolf does sports on Channel 2 here in New York. You can see it, well, on Channel 2, and you also see it on the satellite. The newscast is getting better, but they need a stronger anchor. I don't want to get into the... I don't want to, you know, go the whole, but there's some stuff, pretty good stuff on Channel 2. It's gotten better.
Mm-hmm.
But we need a couple more slots to be filled. But you're great on it. Another guy, other sports guy, is pretty good, too. So.
Oh, Gary Apple.
That's a good team.
Yeah.
But Warner, there's only one Warner Wolf.
No, of course.
So. Yeah.
Warner will be down covering a parade today for Channel 2, by the way.
That's right.
If somebody identify the players, of course. Warner will think it's Elson Howard, sir. Miller Huggins and those people.
That's right.
All right, well, we're out of time. Four till y'all.
Excuse me, is this the House of Truth?
Indeed, it is, my son.
Why, in the name of God's other son, are we honoring a man who has called us hideous dopes, evil dirtbags, sniveling morons, jack-in-the-box idiots, big fat losers, humorless stiffs, pant loads, creeps, scum buckets, evil bastards, and sons of bitches? So what if he's right? He's still gone too far, folks. Don has agreed, while in Washington, to serve as a skin graft donor for the Smithsonian's dinosaur restoration project.
He bestows combining the qualities of President Bill Clinton and Boris Yeltsin. He's a sickly old drunk with the morals of a Detroit crack hole, be Jesus. And he's more full of crap than the Brooklyn Museum, though, isn't he, now?
Don is now my co-worker at MSNBC. I host Equal Time. That's MSNBC's version of the CNN hit program Crossfire. Don hosts Imus in the Morning, MSNBC's version of Fox's hit program When Animals Attack.
The biggest snake is Pete Domenici, who I'll never speak to again. He's a horrid individual. I'm sitting at the head table with a weasel, a phony, and Tim Russert.
We all know about the 25-year age difference between Imus and his wife, Deirdre. Even Woody Allen is shocked, but Strom Thurmond is bursting with pride.
What an amazing life this man has led. He himself said he's had more ups and downs than a White House intern. And you can actually read his life in his face. Don has what most people would call a classically weather-beaten face, which means people keep asking me whether his face has been beaten.
Of course, Imus married a babe, literally a babe. It was one of those marriages where his teeth were starting to fall out while hers were just coming in.
The fact of the matter is that the I-Man would be the first to acknowledge that he is not aging as much as he is decomposing.
Why do I have this image of Senator Lieberman and Bill Bennett hunched over their computers at 2:30 in the morning trading porno website addresses? Making absolutely sure that they really, really are offended.
You know, people often ask me, and ask Don, how he met his wife, Deirdre. 10 years ago, he went shopping at Toys R Us and left the store with the wrong shopping cart.
Now, you may not know this about Don. He has combined his love for children with his passion for books. And so he is producing the Imus collection of children's books. It'll be out just in time for Christmas. And I have a pre...
More threats of violence against students at school. Police in Cleveland uncovered...
...peace. Other family memorabilia. There's a small brooch with the braided hair of Maria and Peter. Hair was something that was used in jewelry. It was woven into wreaths. It was one of the mementos that was kept by a mother and passed down from mother to daughter and so forth. And the other person who was remembered almost universally and revered almost as a god was George Washington. And we have our own Washington piece that is surrounded by pearls. It has a lock of his hair with a GW on it. There's some forks that have come down through the family, silverware, bits and pieces that all belong to the Jays and have the mark or the engraving on them that you'll have an opportunity to see that you wouldn't see if you came to visit. There's also a wonderful suit of clothing that comes from the Paris era. It's a little bit more decorative than John Jay would have worn. He usually wore a very plain black suit and simple stock. This is a wonderful celery green cut velvet jacket with green silk pants and waistcoat. And we have that. We call it his court suit. Family tradition says that it was purchased to be worn, to be presented at court in Paris. Coming into the house, we have between 20 and 25,000 people, but we have between 80 and 90,000 people who use the grounds regularly, whether it be for naturalists who come to enjoy the bird populations and things of this nature. We have restored gardens on the property, herb gardens. There are walking tours of the property. And some just come to enjoy being here and knowing that this site is here and part of their heritage and part of their community.
John Jay was born in New York City in 1745, and he was a principal founder of this nation. When Washington became president in 1789, he knew that he would have to choose which people should be placed in the major government offices. And he balanced the choice of these men among New England, the Middle States, and the South. And he knew that he wanted John Jay to serve in the federal government. And so the two areas that Jay was expert in was in foreign affairs and in the law. He had served 10 successful years in diplomacy, first as a diplomat abroad and establishing and acquiring the independence of America, and then as the Secretary for Foreign Affairs. But after 10 years of service in diplomacy, he was attracted by the challenge of the law, having been Chief Justice of New York State for a year, and so he chose to be the Chief Justice. And President Washington nominated him, and the Senate confirmed his appointment in September of 1789. And he took his oath of office in October of 1789 as the Chief Justice. Now, the greatest challenge for John Jay as the Chief Justice, the first Chief Justice of the United States, was to launch an untried federal judicial system. For never before had the United States had a Supreme Court. When Jay was Chief Justice, in his 5 years, there were 11 cases in the Supreme Court. By 1801, in the first dozen years of the Supreme Court, there were 79 cases decided. So that because the court was a new institution, it took some time for the caseload to develop. And now, of course, we have 9 justices, 1 a chief justice and 8 associate justices. He would be remembered for launching the new federal judicial system, which was untried as the nation never before had a Supreme Court. He would also be remembered for insisting on an independent judiciary, and also for being a proponent of judicial reform, and also for being a proponent for the just powers of the Supreme Court under Article 3, Section 2. And he was very eloquent in his addresses and in his appeals, and he would also be remembered as the first Chief Justice of the United States. And he was 43 years old when he was appointed the first Chief Justice by President George Washington in 1789, And to this day, he is still the youngest man to be named the Chief Justice of the United States.
About a half-hour drive from the John Jay homestead is this house in Rye, New York, which was the residence of John Jay's son, Peter. It was built in 1838 on the site of John Jay's childhood farmhouse. This Greek Revival-style home is currently being restored. It's privately owned, but open to the public for tours on a limited schedule. John Jay is buried nearby in a private family cemetery that is still being used by his descendants. The John Jay Homestead in Katona, New York, is open for tours between April and October. For more information, write to the John Jay Homestead site, Post Office Box 832, Katona, New York, 10536, or call 914-232-5651.
Here's what's coming up on America and the Courts. In 2 weeks, the Supreme Court Bar hosts a tribute to the late retired Associate Supreme Court Justice Harry Blackmun, who died in March at the age of 90. Next week, Chief Justice William Rehnquist delivers a lecture to students and faculty of West Virginia University Law School. And Associate Supreme Court Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg speaks to members of the International Women's Forum. Join us on America and the Courts, Saturday evenings at 7 Eastern, 4 p.m. for viewers on the West Coast. You can find additional programming information for America and the Courts on C-SPAN's internet website. Our address is cspan.org. Select the Guide to Programs entry, then select Courts.
American Perspectives, our weekly look at the cultural and historical side of American life. This edition begins with a charity roast of radio talk show host Don Imus, hosted by the Spina Bifida Association. Roasters include senators and journalists. Then at 9:35 Eastern, former Democratic Party fundraiser Johnny Chung talks about the campaign finance investigation and how it's affected his life. And at 10:40, Kay James discusses the goals of the conservative movement. Our weekly look at the cultural and historical side of American life, American Perspectives, begins in just a moment. Right now on our companion network, C-SPAN 2, our weekend-long look at nonfiction book-related programming continues with History on Book TV. Author Farrah Jasmine Griffin discusses her book, Beloved Sisters and Loving Friends, letters from Rebecca Primus of Royal Oak, Maryland, and Addie Brown of Hartford, Connecticut. Tomorrow, Biography on Book TV features former President George Bush talking about his book, All the Best. And you can see that at noon, 6, and midnight Eastern on C-SPAN 2's Book TV. Now to the roast of radio talk show host Don Imus. On Tuesday, the Spina Bifida Association sponsored this dinner featuring former advisor to President Clinton, Paul Begala, and Senators Pete Domenici, John Kerry, Joseph Lieberman, and John McCain. The 90-minute event was emceed by NBC's Tim Russert.
Ladies and gentlemen, Hal Pote, president of the Spina Bifida Foundation.
Thank you. On behalf of the association, the foundation, and the 70,000 people in this country affected by spina bifida, I have two brief messages for you this evening. The first is to say thank you to Don Imus, to Tim Russert, to the other participants in this evening's festivities, and most importantly, to Al Hunt and Judy Woodruff for organizing this. My second message is this. Of all of the birth defects that cause permanent disability, spina bifida occurs more frequently than any other. 2,500 births each year in the United States alone, and the effects can be devastating. But we've got this one in our headlights. First, 50 to 75% of spina bifida cases can be prevented if women take the appropriate dosage of folic acid prior to becoming pregnant. Second, genetic researchers are focused today on identifying the genetic markers that indicate a predisposition to spina bifida. And third, if spina bifida does occur, there is some very exciting fetal surgery being conducted today that indicates that it's possible that we may be able to prevent, if not all, very many of the effects of spina bifida prior to a child being born. So, we are making a difference, and we know what it takes to make a very big difference. And we will do that with the help and the support of people like you. So, from all of us in the spina bifida family, thank you for your help.
Thank you, Hal. First things first, compliments of the NBC News Desk. After the first inning, Atlanta won, New York won. And there'll be periodic updates throughout the evening. At your table are raffle tickets. If you would like to participate in the raffle, there are three prizes, $1,500 cash, $2,500 cash, and a Porsche Boxster 1999. Compliments of Porsche Cars North America and Tischer Porsche. We're going to pull that ticket in about a half hour. If you're interested, go to the back of the room and file your raffle ticket and be the lucky winner. And I promise you, we will have the most objective, honest, respected person draw that ticket. Mark on it. One last announcement. Before we begin, an announcement from the hotel management. Immediately following tonight's dinner, there will be a reception for Pat Buchanan's presidential campaign in the Eva Braun Room. Black tie is optional, but white hoods are mandatory. As you know, Mark Shields graced us with his presence for 10 years, and he is incomparable. So I'd like to begin by telling his favorite Washington story. It involves the revered First Lady Barbara Bush, the embattled Chief of Staff John Sununu, who went to her and said, "Barbara, I don't understand it. I'm doing a great job, a terrific job, and people don't seem to appreciate me. Why is it that people seem to take such an instant dislike to me?" And she looked at him and she said, "Because it saves time, John." Our first roaster is another John. Double entendre there, huh? And I thought it best to introduce him by simply reading his book, number 5 on the New York Times bestseller list, Faith of My Fathers, John McCain. I commend to you page 154. At some point during my time at flight school, I began dating a local girl whom I had met at Trader John's. She made her living there under the name Marie the Flame of Florida. She was a remarkably attractive girl with a great sense of humor, and I was quite taken with her. Since she was otherwise engaged on Fridays and Saturday nights, our dates occurred on Sunday evening when her bar was closed. I took her to meet some of my friends and fellow flyers. Most of my friends' wives were from privileged families and had been educated at distinguished Eastern schools. Marie, the Flame of Florida, had a more interesting biography. Marie sensed that the young wives, while certainly not rude to her, were less than entirely at ease in her presence. So she sat silent, not wishing to impose on anyone or intrude in the conversation going on around her. After a while, she became a little bit bored. Quietly, she reached into her purse, withdrew a switchblade, popped open the blade, and with a look of complete indifference, began to clean her fingernails. My startled host and guest stared at her with looks ranging from disbelief to alarm. Marie seemed not to notice nor care and concentrated on her task. A short time later, recognizing her presence had perhaps subdued the party, I thanked our host for hospitality, bid goodbye, and took my worldly, lovely Flame of Florida outside. I was able to find the original galleys and with this addendum. She then asked, "Is you interested in a good time?" I replied, "Depends what is." How presidential, John McCain.
Now it'll be more believable when I assert that when I wrote that book, I did not plan on running for president of the United States. Speaking of running for president of the United States, we in Arizona have a very unique challenge. Barry Goldwater from Arizona ran for president of the United States. Morris Udall from Arizona ran for president of the United States. Bruce Babbitt from Arizona ran for president of the United States. And Arizona may be the only state in America where mothers can't tell their children that someday they can grow up and be president of the United States. My old dear friend Barry Goldwater was my campaign chairman in 1986. When I ran for the Senate on election night, he got a little nostalgic and he said, "John, if I'd have been elected president in 1964 and kicked Lyndon Johnson's ass, you'd have never spent all those years in a Vietnamese prison camp." I said, "You're right, Barry. It would have been a Chinese prison camp." He was not amused. Following in with all these great speakers that are here, I feel a bit like Zsa Zsa Gabor's fifth husband, who on her wedding night said, "I know what I'm supposed to do, I just don't know how to make it interesting." And you know, it's kind of a cute line. It goes, I forgot where I stole it. It goes over best at Republican Women's Club meetings, I find. And several years ago, I was at a dinner when one of our colleagues was retiring, and I was about the ninth one in line, so I got up and very cleverly said, "I feel like Zsa Zsa Gabor's fifth husband, dot, dot, dot." The person who followed me immediately was Senator John Warner. He was not amused either. Still isn't. I'd like to thank you, Tim, and each and every one of you for lending your support to this worthy cause. And, of course, we'd also like to thank Mark Shields, who hosted this event for a decade. Mark started his own charitable cause, and that's the cure for Bob Novak. We wish him every success. And, of course, Al and Judy, thank you for everything that you have done, and thank you for your commitment to this wonderful cause. You know, they say you judge a man by the company he keeps. And if so, look at the Rogues Gallery that's here tonight to say a few words about the I-Man, a true collection of jerks. Paul Begala, terrific. Paul Begala, nothing like inviting a spin doctor to say a few words from the heart. I'm sure that you've seen his television show, Paul and Ollie North. They're the Burton and Ernie of cable television, although I think that they're the Ren and Stimpy. But John Kerry, John was thinking about running for president, as you know. He and I had several conversations. Then he saw he'd be up against Gore and Bradley and thought, "There's too much charisma and electricity there for me." A good friend from Connecticut, Joe Lieberman, you know you've hit rock bottom when you're the warm-up back for Joe Lieberman. Last but not least, Pete Domenici. Now, I hope that Pete will give us a few words about the budget. I haven't had a good nap today. And by the way, Imus Ranch is not located in Roswell, New Mexico, but all of us who read the National Enquirer avidly know about the alien landing that took place in Roswell, New Mexico, right? We all read the National Enquirer and know about that. But what a lot of people don't know is 9 months to the day after the alien landing in Roswell, New Mexico, Pete Domenici was born. You know, we're about, well, doesn't he look like, anyway, I won't keep that up. You know, we're about to come up with a bumper sticker in my state: "Keep Arizona's highways beautiful, keep Imus in New Mexico." You know, Don Imus is a curious mix of public man who cherishes his privacy, and he's obviously doing this out of the goodness of his heart. You see, tonight is being broadcast live on C-SPAN, and IMUS average to large audience is he's accustomed to. He doesn't like, however, millions of viewers seeing him on cable. I guess it's a good thing he's on MSNBC. Does anybody ever here see MSNBC? No, there's one. There's one. Paid employees and blood relatives are the ones. Recently, the MSNBC website featured, and I'm not kidding now, what it calls the IMUS question of the moment. And that question, and I'm telling you this is true, I'm not making it up, reads as follows. IMUS is going to endorse John McCain. You think IMUS going to A, stick with him till the bitter end, B, drop him like a bad habit once trouble hits? Well, the results are in. Some 600 people voted, and nearly 400 of them said that the I-man is going to drop me like a bad habit. I have no idea how long it took Mitch McConnell to click on the site 400 times. You know, Don Imus has remarkable people skills. Who better to be my, as President of the United States, personal ambassador to the tobacco companies? You know, we've become close friends, and I hope I'm not revealing too much, but Don has told me that he does undergo therapy. He's trying to get in touch with his inner egomaniac. I think he should be running for the Reform Party nomination for president. In him, you can see reflections of other Reform Party candidates. The endearing shyness of Donald Trump, the cuddly warmth of Pat Buchanan, and the obsession with younger women of Warren Beatty. We all know about the 25-year age difference between Imus and his wife Deirdre. Even Woody Allen is shocked, but Strom Thurmond is bursting with pride. Many of you know my wife Cindy, who's here tonight as well. You may not know this, Don, but Cindy's family is in the beer business, and they asked me to pass on a message to you. Thank you, Don Imus, and God bless you for all you've done. As Tim mentioned, I have recently written a book about my family. I didn't think it was appropriate to try to sell my book tonight. Random House, $24.95. I want to mention it, Amazon.com, because I think it's relevant. Number 5 on the bestseller list, 5th week. But they're making a movie out of my book, and I was on Fox News Sunday the other morning, and they said, after I'd sold the movie rights, who's going to play you? I said, I am for Tom Cruise. My kids want Danny DeVito. So, but the real problem is, who's going to play Imus? On first thought was Walter Matthau, but then we decided we needed someone older and less compassionate. Today is the 32nd anniversary, the 32nd anniversary of my plane being shot down over Vietnam. You can't imagine what it's like to fall that fast. I was dropping faster than Al Gore's poll numbers. My experience as a prisoner of war was something I'll carry with me as long as I live. You can't imagine how lonely and isolated I felt. It was like being a minority outreach coordinator for the Pat Buchanan campaign. And after a while, you get bitter, then you get paranoid, sort of like every single day of Don Imus' life. But what kept me going in prison was the belief that I was there for a purpose, that I was protecting the American way of life. Imagine my horror to come back home years later and find out that Imus was number one. While I was there, the North Vietnamese would put us through the worst kinds of psychological abuse, an experience from which some of us who were held there may never fully recover. They bombarded us with the most god-awful music and noise available, assaulting our senses with their patriotic hymns such as Springtime in a Liberated Zone. I asked my mother how many air pirates we shot down today, but the worst, the very, very worst thing they did to brutalize me and my fellow POWs was to barrage us daily with an awful reminder that American culture is in a steep, steep decline. For the first time, thanks to the cooperation of the current government in Vietnam, I've brought the actual tape that nearly destroyed our morale in prison.
I'm a supermorning.
In all seriousness, thank you, I-Man, and thank you all for this evening.
We are honored to have with us the Secretary of Commerce, William Daley, the Secretary of Health and Human Services, Donald Shalala, and the Secretary of Agriculture, Dan Glickman. Thank you all for coming. Mr. Imus said he saw the three of them having a drink earlier at the bar, and it looked like the bar scene from Star Wars. Very nice, Don. Yeah. As you know, Senator Joe Lieberman is the only Orthodox Jew in the Senate, but not for long. Oy vey, Hillary's almost Jewish. It appears that Hillary Rodham Clinton's step-grandfather's name is Max Rosenberg. So we've gone from the Cubs to the Yankees, and from a Yale Bula Bula to a New York Yenta. Joe Lieberman, popular, thoughtful Democrat from Connecticut, has worked hard over the last 11 years to cultivate a national reputation as a voice of values, a crusader against the culture grown coarse and crude, a leader of unquestioned moral authority, tarnished only by one thing. He appears regularly on the Imus in the Morning radio program. Joe Lieberman.
Thank you, Tim. Nobody's perfect. That newspaper is not part of the regular Yiddish lessons I'm giving to Hadassah Rodham Clinton. But you'll see as it goes on. It is a great pleasure to welcome Don Imus back to Washington and to congratulate him on his courage in returning after that disastrous speech at the correspondents' dinner. You know, those of us who are friends of the Imans were really quite concerned about him that night. I, for one, couldn't imagine how Don felt giving a speech that infuriated so many people at the White House. 2 years and one intern later, I understood. So we bonded, you know. And today, I am really one of Imus's biggest fans. But our relationship, as so many of Don's, had a rocky start. 10 years ago, when I was elected to the Senate, His Eminence Cardinal McGurk. Yeah, I have trouble with Irish names, Bernard. Forgive me. Called the office and asked if I would come on the show. And my media-savvy chief of staff said, remembering Don from an earlier incarnation in New York, said absolutely not, without telling me. I would then go out. Incidentally, when I said no, Don banned me from the show for life, savaged me regularly. The kid doesn't even know where the restroom is, the Senate floor is, et cetera, et cetera. I would go out with all the idealism and hard work of my freshman year as a senator. I remember one day I delivered a speech on all my plans for rescuing our economy at the Milford, Connecticut Chamber of Commerce. I asked for questions, and all the questions were, why won't you go on Imus' show? So I went back to the office and said, what's going on here? Well, we turned it down. I said, you better call up and tell him I want to go on. Well, one of my press people called him up. He taped the conversation. There's nothing illegal about that, is there, Fred? No. And then I went on the air and said that not only now, because I was groveling at his feet, which was a preface, as we all know, as listeners of the show, to sucking up to him, that not only did he ban me for life, he banned me for the afterlife. Now, Don, now that you and I have gotten to know each other, I feel comfortable tonight in saying that you have about as much a chance of becoming a member of the Afterlife Admissions Committee as Pat Buchanan has of becoming rabbi at my synagogue. Anyway, as is his nature, he forgave me for my sins, rescinded the ban, and this year I proudly, though very quietly, celebrated my 10th anniversary as a guest on Imus in the Morning. And of course, a lot has changed over those 10 years. 10 years ago, believe it or not, a lot of people wouldn't admit they listened to the show. People would come up to me and say, hey, I heard you on Imus. You know, I don't listen to the show. Well, how'd you hear me? I was turning the dial and I heard your voice. So I stayed for the interview. Others who did admit they listened to the show would say to me in a reaction to a media appearance that was very unusual, hey, big guy, I heard you on Imus. Sort of in the tone that they would say, hey, I saw you coming out of a topless nightclub. But that's all changed. Now people positively brag about listening to the I-Man. And when I'm on, they say they heard me on Imus in the same tone that they might say I heard you on, well, Meet the Press. It's... All right, now this next one is complicated. Stick with me, all right? Now, another change that's happened in the 10 years is that the I-Man, of course, has gone from broadcasting locally in New York to national syndication, reaching millions of listeners coast to coast. His migration pattern, that is beginning in metropolitan New York and then spreading throughout the country, sounds familiar, doesn't it? Which might be why researchers have come to refer to Don as the West Side virus. You know, West Nile, you know, you got it. Okay, the other big change, these are much more easily comprehensible. You know, I had trouble with my staff in sitting down and working on my material tonight because most of them are half my age. And I had to say at different points, no, I cannot tell the syphilis joke. You know? All right. Later, I'll be available for private tellings of the story. Well, the other big change, of course, with the Imus in the Morning program is that it is not only broadcast on radio, but now telecast on the aforementioned and, may I say, much-watched MSNBC, which, considering the way Don looks, should earn him a chapter in Profiles in Courage. The fact of the matter is that the I-Man would be the first to acknowledge that he is not aging as much as he is decomposing. But you know the kind of guy he is. He's the comeback kid. He has the ability to turn most problems to his advantage. I happen to know that earlier today, he gained access to one of the private sections of the Capitol by convincing a security guard that he was Strom Thurmond's father. All right, and yet, as another example of his charitable nature, which is so much in evidence here tonight, Don has agreed, while in Washington, to serve as a skin graft donor for the Smithsonian's Dinosaur Restoration Project. These I like, and here's the last one. in this series. In fact, I happen to know that before the paleontologists at the Smithsonian do an autopsy on that woolly mammoth the archaeologists recently dug up, they're asking Don to come by to identify the body. Of course, there have been great changes in Don's personal life over the last 10 years. Most important, his marriage to the beautiful and talented Deirdre and the birth of their adorable son, Wyatt. Chris Dodd and I were very proud that the I-Man married a woman from our home state. But I must say, we didn't realize until then that Connecticut had a law permitting mail order brides. Now, Don and Deirdre actually have a wonderful relationship, like all couples. Of course, they occasionally have a disagreement. But Don always ends the arguments by admitting that he was the one who was wrong and pledging to make it up to Deirdre at next year's prom. Oh. And Wyatt, well, there were times 10 years ago when all this started, when Imus to me, sounded a lot like Lenny Bruce. Lately, he's been sounding a lot more like Dr. Barry Brazelton. Have you noticed? I know Wyatt is a very, very special child and clearly the apple of his dad's eye. But this little kid gets more adulation on Imus in the Morning than the baby Jesus gets on the 700 Club, for God's sake. All right. Over the last 10 years, we have also been exposed to a dizzying display of the I-Man's various artistic talents. We now know that he is not only a master of radio, but he is an accomplished author as well. His first book, God's Other Son, is probably the only printed work with a religious theme that is less readable than the untranslated version of the Dead Sea Scrolls, which proves, I suppose, that you can't compare the quality of two books based on their sales. You got to think about that one. Don's second book, entitled Two Guys, Four Corners, is a photographic essay of Don and his brother Fred's attempt to find their way home in the farm country after a very long night of wandering. At least that's what we think it is. The fact is that the quality of the photographs printed in this book make the Blair Witch Project look like a Merchant Ivory film. Anyway, in the spirit of the I-Man's rising and elevating cultural tastes, I thought I would end tonight with a quote not from Kinky Friedman or the Texas Jew Boys, but from Puccini's famous aria, Nessun Dorma, which ends, as we've heard Pavarotti and others sing it, with the great phrase, Al Alba Vincerò, which loosely translated means, when the dawn comes, I shall be victorious. So it is with the I-Man. All of us know that regardless of what we say or do here tonight, when the dawn comes, he will go on the air. And he will be victorious. And we, as his faithful listeners, know that we too, each in our own way, are victorious each morning we tune him in. Entertained by his humor, some of us appropriately deflated by his satire, informed and even educated by his thoughtful conversations with his guests, and inspired truly by his good deeds, including his willingness to be the roastie tonight, which has done so much for the Spina Bifida Association. Thank you, Don Imus, and God bless you and your family.
Top of the third, Atlanta 2, New York 1. Oh, wait a minute. Beeper's going off.
Oh, my God.
Atlanta 4, New York 1. And the hits keep on coming. It's a runaway. You got to stay now. And Associated Press is moving a story. Elizabeth Dole has announced she is sending her campaign staff to John McCain, her hairspray to Donald Trump. A couple announcements. On behalf of the Spina Bifida Association of America, we'd like very much to thank Bennett Zier and Sports Talk 980. They were sensational in help promoting this. Also, special thanks to NetCert Education Centers and Sabatini of London. Thank you both for your very generous support. And because of their support and yours, this dinner is sold out. More than 750 guests. We have raised tonight $250,000. Paul Begala said, big deal, we raised that with more than one Chinese coffee at the White House. Thanks a lot, Paul. Very, very nice. Our next roaster. He came to the Senate from New Mexico in 1972. 1972. I have here a copy of the Cox Report. Chinese espionage at the nuclear labs at Los Alamos, New Mexico, began in earnest in 1972. Great job, Senator Pete Domenici.
Hello, everyone. Wait a minute. These aren't my notes. This isn't my file. These are some perspiration-stained notes from 1996. Who left those here? Imus, welcome back to Washington. It's really, really great to have you before another group of D.C. dignitaries, and we feel your pain. It's a great pleasure to join all of you this evening in paying tribute to the man who once told his national radio audience in his inimitable way, "The biggest snake is Pete Domenici, who I'll never speak to again. He's a horrid individual." Now, it went downhill from there, which is one reason why I'm so happy to be here with you tonight. But being called a horrid individual by Don Imus hardly puts me in an elite group. As a matter of fact, I'm sitting at the head table with a weasel, a phony, and Tim Russert, who Imus tells you is wrong about everything. Everything, he says. But as listeners of this radio program, and all of you that do know, our honoree is not about to let anything stand in the way of his well-cultivated outrage. No wonder he's focused on Washington. In a city full of cranky egomaniacs, he fits right in. Just imagine, Imus standing the I-man on the floor of the United States Senate, sharing with his colleagues such well-considered views as these, which I have culled from his broadcast anthology. Alan Greenspan, Crazy Al. John Kerry, the Larry Fortinsky of the United States Senate. Al Gore, the Albatross. Ross Perot, the jug-eared little Martian. And then there are his observations on the media. Wolf Blitzer, that U-boat commander. On Dan Rather, loony. On Bernard Shaw, a nutcase. On David Brinkley, he looks like E.T. On George Will, wears clothes that make him feel pretty. Mary McGrory, Elton John's lookalike. And Bob Woodward, a dope. But it could be worse. After all, earlier today, he said, "Before I stopped drinking, I was a very unpleasant person." Don Imus is doing for civility what Donald Trump has done for modesty. Pat Buchanan for history and Jesse Ventura for honesty. After all, the I-Man is an inspiration behind the V-chip for radio. The truth, of course, is that Mr. Imus only picks on famous and important people because they are famous and important. He picks on everyone else because they are not. The well-kept secret is that deep down, deep, deep, deep down, Don Imus is a nice man. He is really trying to play the role that Will Rogers once played in our national life, the cowboy philosopher, the poet laureate, the man who'll say things everyone else is just too darn decent to say. Imus is interested in holding our politicians and our journalists to account, and as soon as he's finished licking John McCain's boots tonight, he'll start on Katherine Graham's heels. As many of you know, he is building a ranch for sick children in my state of New Mexico, and just below that ranch house, he's building a casino where all the spies will spend their money and relax after the hard days they're having at Los Alamos. But it wasn't always this way. Don Imus wasn't always the king of New York, the lord of radio, the crown prince of politics. Once upon a time, he was the host and the toast of Cleveland. And I have here with me tonight the evidence of his rapier wit from days gone by. Find it here. Here it is. This is his first recording. Imus in the morning. 1,200 hamburgers to go. Now, the success of this record put him right up there with these other luminaries, such as comedy legends, Chuck Barris, Nipsey Russell, and I could go on, but I don't have to. By now, you can all plainly see what kind of man Don Imus is. Being called a horrid individual by Don Imus is like being called boring by Al Gore. Or neat by Trent Lott. Or wacko by Bob Dornan. It's a badge of honor, and I wear it proudly. I would like to say one serious word. I want to congratulate the I-Man on the wonderful work he's undertaken in my state to give children with cancer a taste of a real ranch life. The Imus Ranch is a great idea, and this man has given much of his time and much of his money to make a life a little easier and a little more fun for kids who could use some good cheer in their lives. President Reagan said, there's nothing better for the inside of a man than the outside of a horse. And Don Imus is putting that philosophy to work in New Mexico. Which brings me to a little bit of other news. Larry King and his wife are expecting again. The older men are all having kids. Larry, Imus, is Strom still here? But the fact is that Imus is doing something terrific for kids, and I think he's great. But I would remind him, as John Glenn's wonderful wife, Annie, used to remind our famous former colleague from Ohio from time to time, there's one less great man in the world than you think. So I want to thank all of you, ladies and gentlemen, for giving me an opportunity to be with you tonight. Or in the immortal words of Pat Buchanan, Danke. Auf Wiedersehen.
There are three couples who have been to every one of these dinners. Ben Bradley and Sally Quinn. Kate Lair, and we hope permanent presidential debate moderator Jim Lair. Andrea Mitchell, and I promised you that this drawing
would be fair and objective. Who is better? Who is more trusted? Who is more honorable than to pick the winner of our prizes than the chairman of the Federal Reserve, Alan Greenspan? Before we have the drawing, Mr. Greenspan, I wanted to ask you about the market.
Apples are selling well today.
Where is our draw? We have to pull the... Where is it here? Oh, it's in the back. Mr. Allen has to go to the back? Here it comes. All right, speaking it up here. On the way up here, Allen, the overvaluation has become a theme I've heard a lot of discussion about. Have you seen this article from the American Enterprise Institute for Public Policy Research by Lawrence Lindsay?
Unfortunately.
And what's the headline?
I can't read.
Alan Greenspan, a wild and crazy guy.
He got it from him.
It says here you play a wicked saxophone.
I'm wicked or the saxophone?
Where is that drawing? Quick. We need a baseball score. Here we go. You're a good sport. Oh, the drum roll, the music. All right, the first pick will be for third prize, $1,500. Mr. Chairman, who's it going to be?
Andrea gave me her ticket to go on top. I can't see the front.
And the winner is Pia Pialarsi. Pia, you here? There you go, $1,500. Do you think Alan Greenspan should be reappointed to the Fed?
No autograph.
Mr. Greenspan, Mr. Chairman, $2,500. Guy Bowen in the card throw. Cherry Hill, New Jersey. He'll be guarded by Bo Deedle. $2,500, Guy. Thank you very much. And this is it. The 1999 Porsche Boxster. And the winner is, Mr. Chairman, Sally Reposananer. Reposananer. Sally. Sally E. Representative, 2033 Mayfair, McLean Court. Are you here? Well, Church. Huh? That's it. It says here, WSM White, single woman, 70353. Congratulations, you win. Dr. Chairman, go take care of her.
Oh, yeah, that's a wildly crazy guy.
All right. And you wonder why I call him the monetary stud. You want to say anything else?
No.
Goodbye. All right. What a good sport, the chairman.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, a special presentation by the Spina Bifida Association, I-Man the Video.
Gentlemen, the Vice President of the United States.
Mr. Vice President, I need you to make a tape for this Donna Ashford.
For who? Are you kidding?
Donna.
Are you kidding? Sir, do you know what he said about me?
Al Gore is one of the most evil people on the planet. I know I would be dissuaded from that position.
And what a transparent weasel.
Well, we already know he's a phony. Al Gore, I mean, it's just beyond the Lloyd Grove politics, Al Gore. Al Gore, the Antichrist. What's the difference between Al Gore and Charles Manson? Well, there's not much.
He's an evil person.
He's a phony. He's the phoniest person on the planet, Al Gore. I mean, he's a disgraceful human being.
Look, it's a big deal. It's for charity. He's a nice guy. I mean, come on. Nice guy?
About to fire everybody on this program?
Oh, you shut up and finish your sports report. I'm going to fire you. Shut up.
You're a lying little weasel, Lou.
Yeah, and I'm a jerk.
Get out of here!
Get the hell out of here. You remember about a year ago, a moron who went down to Washington and made fun of the president and his first lady?
But that doesn't mean that I'm sorry I did it. I'm not sorry I did it. I would never apologize to the president of the United States or his wife, even my life, both of them, for anything.
Just sit right back and tune him in. The I-Man's on the air. A cowboy had a wrinkled face and orange-colored hair. You work for him, he makes you feel you're nothing but a slave.
And here's another thing. Stop referring to me as a wrinkled-up old skunk.
Sorry.
Because it's horrible for my image. And a wrinkled-up old fossil. How is that helpful for my image? I'm on television now. How is that helpful?
The rubber chicken-faced doofus.
That's not helpful. Rubber chicken-faced doofus is not the image that I want to portray.
You know, a face that needs to be spackled.
You have...
That's a
probably rollerblading.
Stop it now! That's enough! Shut up!
Wipe your chin now. You got spit in here. Okay, that's good.
That's really ugly.
It's just terrible.
Thank God we're on a radio. You need your voice to sound like my face looks. Go ahead.
Go on, you face.
We wish him harm and hope that soon he's resting in his grave. Resting in his grave.
But he might be. I can't wait to river dance in the I-Man's grave. Wonder what that'd be like. Come on up, Deirdre.
Cardinals are dancing.
Well, it's goodbye to the I-Man. You took so light a dime. The more I did me praying, the more you just grew old. But sure as Oprah's gay, we finally passed away. And now just like me, but why do you talk as nice and cold?
What's the difference between the I-Man and a grape?
I don't know.
When the grape withers away, it's still useful to Jesus. Can you die soon enough? Maybe you're not clapping the right way.
He's married now and all he eats is salad and some cheese. While Deidre's home, he helps her prep for the SAT.
You'll be late for school, honey. He loves children.
He married one. My wife is not 14 years old, Mr. Russer.
You know, I've combed through this budget deal, trying to see how it impacts the average family. So I chose the IMS family. For Don, good news is Medicare, Social Security, and the death tax are all secure. For Deirdre, we have increased funding for Head Start and Hooked on Phonics. And most importantly, the estate tax waiver.
The I-Man, his brother Fred, and that overpriced picture book.
There's a fella up here with his brother got this picture book. Not too many words in it. And what ones there is, mostly cuss words. What I can't figure is why all these people is not enough to get it. Because it's just a book with a lot of pictures of rocks. Some people call it a stunning photographic essay on the timelessness of the American Southwest. I call it a book with a lot of pictures of rocks.
And the name of your next book
should be Two White Butt Cheeks, One Set of Lips.
Two guys, four corners, indeed. Make you sick. You know those boyhood pictures of Fred and yourself on the cover? How about a book, Two Guys, Four Bullets, you smut you?
I mean, here's what Al Gore doesn't understand, is that we know that he's a phony.
Look, Paul, I value the advice, but give me just one good reason why I should say anything nice about Don Imus.
I'll give you 10 million. He's got 10 million listeners, and a ton of them in the New York primary.
Really?
I may be witnessing the end of my political career. Look what you did for Bob Dole.
Hi, Don. May I call you Don? I want to thank you and your wife, Deirdre, for all that you two have done for the people of our great country. I just want to be your second choice for president. And keep in mind, Bill Bradley just absolutely hates the Dixie Chicks.
You shut up and finish your book before I'm gonna fire you. You're a lying little weasel, Lou.
Yeah, I'm a jerk.
Get out of here! Get the hell out of here.
This begins the revenue-generating portion of tonight's program, Imus in the Evening. Let the roasting begin.
And we'd like to thank Bob Shrum and his Shrum Divine and Donlin for that footage. Thank you very much. Great job, guys. You know, people often ask me and ask Don how he met his wife, Deirdre. 10 years ago, he went shopping at Toys R Us and left the store with the wrong shopping cart. We'd just been given an advanced copy of the new Talk magazine, and it has an exclusive interview with Deirdre Coleman Imus. I can open it and break a story here. It's a Q&A format. Third question. Is there anything, one thing, you'd really like to know about your husband, Don? Answer, Deirdre Coleman. Yes, of course, just one thing. His life expectancy. Speaking of gold diggers, our next guest is Senator John Kerry. What a meteoric rise in life. From a transient hotel room in South Boston to a Victorian mansion, a townhouse in Georgetown, waterfront property in Nantucket, and all he had to do was learn two new little words. I do. Mr. Teresa Hines, Senator John Kerry.
Tim and my colleagues are just deeply jealous that I had the shortest fundraiser in American history. I knew, actually, when I started taking Teresa out that it was going to be very, very special because I received this wonderful love letter from her. And I knew it was from her right away because on the outside in big letters it said, "You may already be a winner." And I'm proud to say that my wife is the only woman in America who actually delivers checks to Ed McMahon's house. You imagine Tim, who has been called, referred to very frequently now as the pit bull of the Sunday talk shows, which obviously all of us here feel is profoundly unfair and demeaning to pit bulls. And This is actually a very historic evening. I don't know how many of you know this, but we have succeeded in pulling together for Spinal Bifida into one room everybody who has ever listened to the IMA show. And I want to express my personal admiration and gratitude to Judy Woodruff and to Al Hunt for all that they've done to make tonight possible. Everyone here agrees. They are really an extraordinary couple. They are a rarity in Washington. Two reporters who have been married and been together for so many years, and I think every single one of you would agree that it's hard for two reporters to keep up the sexual chemistry after so many years. Just look at Evans and Novak. It's also a great honor to be on the same panel as my colleagues, Joe Lieberman and Pete Domenici and John McCain. And Paul Begala is here too, and I joined with all of you in asking why. And you know, I got to tell you, it really is wonderful that Pete Domenici came out here tonight. What can I say about Pete Domenici? Nothing. I don't know him. I've never spoken to him. I don't know. Did you really get elected last time? I mean, he is even more, he is so obscure that even Edmund Morris doesn't claim that he knew him. And my great good friend, John McCain, is not only here, but thriving. His book is rising rapidly on the bestseller list. And I got to tell you, though, I'm a little bit suspicious of the subtitle, Harry Potter and His Friend John McCain. We're all very sorry that Pat Buchanan couldn't be here with us tonight, but you know how he hates big parties. However, it is wonderful that Bob Dole lent his name and his support to this wonderful evening. Now that Elizabeth has dropped out, I gather that Bob is going to be full-time on the McCain campaign. And everybody here has got to agree, it really is pretty spectacular that in retirement he is working as hard as he is to stay up on things. During the campaign finance campaign finance reform debate, we had a little argument about it, but he finally supported it when I convinced him that hard money does not mean a check from Viagra. My good friend Chris Dodd is here, newly married, wonderfully newly married, and I know how grateful we all are for his help here this evening. You know, Chris and I were really shocked by the Jesse Ventura interview. I didn't know that Jesse Ventura would say something so stupid, and Chris didn't know that Playboy had articles. And talking about shock, what a strange year this has been in Washington. I mean, the most surprising thing for me is how many Republican members of the House went into politics for the sex. You have to work on that one, folks. So, ladies and gentlemen, there is a bottom line here tonight. One person in America is being vindicated. Ross Perot was right. There is a giant sucking sound in Washington, and it's four senators kissing Imus's ass. And here we are, Don's enormously anticipated big return to Washington, D.C., a time we've all been waiting for. Here he is, fresh from New York, the home of Don Imus and encephalitis-carrying mosquitoes. Who do you root for? And for the life of me, and I'm sure my colleagues share this, none of us can understand why we're doing this. Why, in the name of God's other son, are we honoring a man who has called us hideous dopes, evil dirtbags, sniveling morons, jack-in-the-box idiots, big fat losers, humorless stiffs, pantloads, creeps, scumbuckets, evil bastards, and sons of bitches? So what if he's right? He's still gone too far, folks. And did you hear what he said about Al Gore? Not just and things there, but he called him a disingenuous weasel. Now, how can you possibly say that about a farmer who single-handedly invented the internet? And what is it about Imus that keeps us coming back? I mean, going on the show has all the fun of a prostate exam without any of the sexual chemistry. And talk about strange. I mean, this guy has dead correspondence on the show. I mean, I don't mean like 60 minutes. I mean dead. Nevertheless, Time Magazine named him one of the 25 most influential people in America. And obviously, it was not just for the show. It was also for the remarkable, insightful advice that he gives. Did you know that Don is the one who told Hillary, go out of town, trust him. What can he do in the White House? He's the one who told Newt Gingrich, go ahead. Like Marianne is going to go public. Now, I want to say something personal about Imus, and I hope you don't mind if I do this. For those of you who don't know him too well, this is being watched by about 23 people on C-SPAN. I want you to know that I really admire Don Imus. You may not be aware of it, but he is a bona fide veteran. He is a Marine. Yes, he served in the Drum and Bugle Corps at Camp Pendleton, and I can't tell you how fascinating it is when he and John McCain get together and swap war stories. But seriously, I mean, stop and think about it for a minute. What an amazing life this man has led. He himself said he's had more ups and downs than a White House intern. And you can actually read his life in his face. Don has what most people would call a classically weather-beaten face, which means people keep asking me whether his face has been beaten. And as many of you know, he had that incredible confrontation with the C-word over a period of time, correspondence dinner. And I have to tell you something. As much as he was ridiculed for it, the truth really is that the White House correspondence dinner was actually one of those breakthrough moments for Don Imus. Remember when all the pundits said that he was accused of rude behavior, cheap theatrics, and general boorishness? By God, that's when it became clear he really is one of us, folks. And do you realize that despite the fact that I have known Don Imus for 5 years now, I still don't know what in the world the I in I-Man stands for? I thought I knew, but then Deirdre got pregnant. Once again, you have to think about that a little bit. It's, and now there's this incredible mania of IPOs around the country, and Don wants to get in on it. There's a huge rumor that he is going to split from MSNBC and offer himself up as an IPO. Wall Street, I want you to know, is not very impressed, and I checked with my broker, and he said, listen, we're looking for new startups with growth potential, not old upstarts with potential growths. Before we came out here, Don said to us proudly that he can trace his ancestry all the way back to the 1850s, as if a United States senator is supposed to be impressed. Hell, Strom Thurmond can trace himself back to the 1850s. By the way, small social note, last night in South Carolina, Strom Thurmond's next wife was born. This Sunday represents a huge demarcation point in the life of Don Imus because it is the first weekend that Deirdre's old enough to go out and trick-or-treat alone. And in honor of Bernie McQuirk, let me just share with you very quickly, but Jesus, which one doesn't belong and why? Which one doesn't belong and why? Elizabeth Dole, John McCain, Don Imus. Well, you miserable old man, answer the question. Which one doesn't belong and why? The answer is John McCain, because he's the only one that Bob Dole complimented during the campaign. So, ladies and gentlemen, as I close, let me say that in spite of the abuse, in spite of the scorn, in spite of the embarrassment, The truth is that some of us can never break away from the I-Man. After I went on IMUS, the Boston Herald described me as a self-absorbed, empty vessel bent on self-promotion. And to his credit, and with my eternal gratitude, Don Imus defended me to the hilt. He said, of all the self-absorbed, empty vessels bent on self-promotion that appear on my show, I am the best. So in conclusion, may I steal an Irish blessing and say, may the railroad rise up to meet you. May the wind be always at your back. May the sun shine warm upon your face. And may you always have a friend of your father willing to expunge your arrest record. Thank you very much.
From the NBC Sports Wire, bottom of the fourth, Atlanta 5, New York 1. From the Reuters News Wire, Bob Dole was just shown a photograph of Jesse Ventura, Pat Buchanan, Donald Trump. He said, hear no evil, see no evil, and evil. Paul Begala, what a career. Gone from working with James Carville to Oliver North. Carville to North. And you all really believe in evolution? Ladies and gentlemen, President Clinton's former hard-driving, fast-talking Texas hitman, Paul Begala.
Oh, I'm sorry. I saw so many senators in one place, I thought I was under subpoena. It's reflex. It is a pleasure to be welcomed warmly by Tim Russert. I, as he alluded to, can remember many Sundays where Tim and I got together, just he and I, and it became like a ritual during that Lewinsky scandal. 9 a.m., go on Meet the Press, evade Tim's questions. 10:30, go to Mass, evade the priest's questions. I want to single out our co-chairs for tonight, Senators Dole and Chris Dodd. First, as those of us who know Bob Dole know, behind that sarcastic sense of humor, there lies a bitter old man. And I want to thank Chris Dodd for his leadership on this. What a legend in my party. Chris Dodd is a man who made the Democratic National Committee what it is today. Bankrupt. John McCain, an honor to be on a panel with you. Sir, I read your book, and I have to tell you, I really identified with your Vietnam experience, Senator. Because I was only 6 years old when your plane was shot down. But I had a very similar experience. Mrs. Reinheimer kept me after class for throwing water balloons at recess. She made me sit in that corner for an hour. I wouldn't break. Okay, I broke. And I feel I ratted on my friend Joey Dumfries. Joey, if you're out there, I'm sorry, Joey, I couldn't take it. Neither can you. Senator Lieberman, my friend and fellow Democrat, known widely as the conscience of the United States Senate. Now think about that. Having the best conscience in the Senate is a little bit like having the best tan at the Conservative Citizens Council. And Senator Pete Domenici is here. He, by the way, you may not know this, he pitched for the Albuquerque Dukes in minor league baseball. And he once hit Ernie Banks. Typical Republican targeting minorities. He said once that if he'd had better control, he'd have been in the major leagues. Senator, if you'd had better control, you'd be the majority leader. And John Kerry, another war hero. But if I read his remarks right just now, maybe just a teeny bit jealous of John McCain and the success of his book, Faith of Our Fathers. And so Senator Kerry is working on his own book, Wealth of Our Wives. Teresa Hines is the heiress of that ketchup fortune, and I think she's been the butt of too many jokes. And I, for one, was offended and upset that no one rose to her defense when the Reverend Jerry Falwell attacked her for handing out condiments in the public schools. That's a think about it, Joe. But the man of the hour, of course, is Don Imus. Don is now my coworker at MSNBC. I host Equal Time. That's MSNBC's version of the CNN hit program Crossfire. Don hosts Imus in the Morning, MSNBC's version of Fox's hit program When Animals Attack. He's sometimes called the thinking man's Howard Stern, but you know, there's a big difference. I mean, Howard Stern has strippers on his show. Imus has senators. Of course, the difference on the Imus show, the boobs are real. But you cannot deny Imus's big-hearted commitment to charity. We all know about the millions he's raised for SIDS, for the ranch, for Krista House, now for Spina Bifida tonight. But what you might not know is after that 1996 White House Correspondents' Dinner, he became the spokesman for the National Flop Sweat Association. I salute you for that, Don, a fellow sufferer. Don is the only guy I know who lives in Manhattan and dresses like the cowboys, unless you count that guy in the Village People. His love for animals, he's the only vegetarian who owns a cattle ranch. He's gonna let the animals die of old age. And his love for animals, of course, only goes so far because of the laws of 38 states. I am a Texan, and I'm also a ranch foreman, by the way, so I know something about cattle. And part of life on a cattle ranch, and I'm curious as to how Don's going to handle this with the kids, because it's not one of the most delicate and pleasant topics on a cattle ranch. It's a process by which we in ranching country, we make male calves after they've been weaned into steers. Okay, and on the ranch, we call that cutting calves. Here in Washington, we call that same procedure being in the Maureen Dowd column. But Don has come a long way. Senator Kerry talked about his experience as a Marine. And he's told the story many times on himself about how when he was a young Marine, he accidentally wound up necking with a transvestite in some border town bar. Accidentally, Don? Of course, he was completely disgusted. Imus wasn't too happy either. But now look at him. He's at the top of his game. He chats amiably with the biggest stars, not only in politics, but in show business. Now think about that. It's a long way to the Dixie Chicks from chicks with... Senator McCain, this is one of your jokes. Sorry. Now, when I told the president that I was doing the Imus roast, he said, well, you know, sounds kind of risky, Polly. Polly, that's his nickname for me. And he has a nickname for Don, too. Shriveled up old son of a bitch, I think. Now, you may not know this about Don. He has combined his love for children with his passion for books. And so he is producing the Imus collection of children's books. It'll be out just in time for Christmas. And I have a preview of some of the titles. Santa Claus is a Fat, Phony Bastard. The Uncomfortable Adventures of Petey Prostate. The Little Engine That Needed Viagra. And the one designed to be a classic from Don, Diapers Are for Daddy Too. I do want to close as some others have, though, with this note. It was a little over 7 years ago that my wife and I were expecting our first child. And Al Hunt turned to me as the grizzled veteran of three children, and he said to me, I know in my head that there was a time when Judy and I didn't have children, but I don't remember in my heart what it felt like. And now that I'm the grizzled veteran of three children, I know now what he meant. And the fact that Judy and Al have put this organization and the other children who have spina bifida so far out in front in their life is such a tribute. And the devotion extends to every child, not just their brave and brilliant Jeffrey. And so I can't wait for the time, because of their commitment and the commitment of all of you in this room, that we have a dinner like this full of laughs to celebrate the cure. Thank you very much.
And now the highlight of our evening, the return of John Donald Imus to the Washington dinner scene. Does everyone remember his speech from hell, March 21, 1996? Let's watch.
Let me see if I can see what it says. S. McDougal called again, says bank needs check and statement, told her vote for in mail, ha ha ha. Jesus, she looked stupid in those tank tops. Pat Buchanan has a certain inherent charm. However, if he gets elected president, 2 weeks later, somebody's knocking on your door at 3 o'clock in the morning.
Just checking. Kind of a name of Imus.
Although, all this stuff about being, Pat being anti-Semitic, I don't know about that. A lot of people aren't aware that he lost a relative in a concentration camp. His uncle fell out of a guard tower. When Cal Ripken broke Lou Gehrig's consecutive game record, his president was at Camden Yards doing play-by-play on the radio with John Miller. Bobby Bonilla hit a double, and we all heard the president in his obvious excitement holler, "Go, baby!" I remember commenting at the time, I bet that's not the first time he said that. Remember the AstroTurf and the pickup?
Job, Don, I'll say it. Really, really good. But notice how Al Gore stuck with Bill Clinton tonight, huh? But yes, Don Imus was once a self-centered, brow-sweating, hair-thinning, self-absorbed, acerbic, cranky, aging, turkey-necked, rhinestone cowboy. But no more. Please welcome the new, kinder, gentler, lovable version, Mr. Cuddly himself, the father of Wyatt Imus, the one and only I-Man.
Are you going to laugh?
Oh, God, that was awful. He was, the last time I spoke, he was sitting, I think here the president was, and the first lady was sitting here, and I was talking about an anchor man who had an intern under his desk. And I wondered why the president was glaring at me. Of course, at that time, the First Lady was still laughing. First of all, I am pleased that I can be a part of an effort to raise money for spina bifida, $250,000 here this evening. As you know, a hideous congenital defect that further confirms that life, of course, indeed is not fair. Knowing Judy Woodruff a little and aware of the situation with Judy and Al's son, Jeffrey, there is nothing I would not do, nothing. Including, obviously, submitting myself to the humiliating spectacle we have all witnessed here this evening. I recognize that many of you wanted to simply get even with me for the outrageous things I've said about you over the years. I didn't, however, expect you to sink to my level to do it. Sitting here this evening, I now have a sense of what Senator McCain went through as a prisoner of war in North Vietnam for 5.5 years. One does wonder, though, why anyone would want me to speak in Washington for any reason. Sort of like asking the Grease Man to keynote an NAACP convention. But as I said, life is not fair. If it were, John Kerry would have Joe Biden's hair. Senator Kerry, as we all know, has decided he does not want to be president. As was the plight of Elizabeth Dole, he too ran into fundraising problems. Teresa suspended his credit card, and Johnny Chung was indicted. The last time I was here, I did refer, unfortunately, to each of the senators, to Larry Fortensky of the upper house. He has demonstrated the inordinate class and style here this evening to have resisted referring to my wife as the Anna Nicole Smith of broadcasting. Senator John McCain has decided he does want to be president, his noble crusade for campaign finance reform apparently resonating with voters. Campaign finance reform is something McCain endorsed, incidentally, the day Charles Keating went to jail. Perhaps the only problem is that he was the subject of a Senate investigation before becoming president. Recent history demonstrates you can do anything after you're elected and still stay in office. Think about that. Use an intern as a humidor and you can't keep your job at the post office. One of the great ironies of the last election is that Bill Clinton was allowed to remain in the Oval Office and Bob Dole got Monica Lewinsky's apartment. Senator Dole could not be here this evening. One does wonder, considering the help he gave Elizabeth in her effort to become president, what exactly is he going to do now with all that Viagra? I guess he could give it to Senator Dodd. Congratulations on your recent marriage, Senator. You do remember that, right? Two words brought the senior senator from Connecticut here this evening. Open bar. I've learned that Edmund Morse is quietly working on a biography of Senator Dodd that employs the same kind of device he used in his Reagan book, a fictional character who grows up with Chris and attends him at every important juncture of his life, named Jack Daniels. Chris is at a table where one of the place cards reads designated driver. That would be reserved for his old friend and... No. This brings us to the junior senator from Connecticut, Joe Lieberman. Why would an ostensibly dignified individual who prides himself on ethics and virtue trivialize himself by participating in this? But then, what do we really know about a man who spots an erection on a cartoon character in a movie and wonders whether Barney has genitals? Why do I have this image of Senator Lieberman and Bill Bennett hunched over their computers at 2:30 in the morning, trading porno website addresses, making absolutely sure that they really, really are offended? Pete Domenici is the senior senator from the state of New Mexico, where we are, as you perhaps know, building a $15 million cattle ranch for kids with cancer. The senator may have to help us with some building codes and get state officials to turn their heads when we flood 3,000 acres with water, so I do want to be kind. New Mexico has a population of 1.7 million people, many of them Mexican-Americans, who incidentally all love the senator, and they have an affectionate little nickname for him, Pendejo, which I'm told means fearless leader. I'd now like to focus on the people who are here this evening who I hate. Paul Begala and Tim Russert. Mo and Larry. God, what a couple of no-good, rotten, Clinton water-carrying, liberal tree-hugging, owl-sucking liberal weasels. This for Russert, though. He does try to hide it with the Meet the Press guest list right out of the World Wrestling Federation. And not just Jesse Ventura every 20 minutes. Matt Drudge, Donald Trump, the banjo boy from Deliverance, James Carville. William, I like the oatmeal on my chin, Sapphire. Bob, honest, I really wrote this book, and these people really said this stuff, Woodward. And that nut Novak. Honest to God, you could rope these people off, charge admission, and let kids pet them. Forgetting the embarrassing exclusive on the name of the president's dog, and the dreadful performance on Jeopardy, Look at the size of this guy. He's not from Buffalo. He is a Buffalo. His butt is big enough it has its own zip code. When Maureen brings the groceries home, they have to hire a rodeo clown to distract him. Oh, God. He was named one of the top 100 Irish Americans by Irish American Magazine, and they're offended when we call him drunks. No, Chris, not you. And Paul Begala, whose career was highlighted when, while still at the White House, he shaved off his beard, making it more difficult to pick him out of a lineup, apparently, was the thinking. Paul, whose most famous remark, well, Monica didn't do anything I wouldn't do. Strangely, most offended Rahm Emanuel. Paul has taken Mary Matlin's place in equal time on MSNBC, sitting to the right, ironically, of Oliver North. This may someday shed light on the deterioration of his relationship with James Carville. I want Judy and Al Hunt and all of the other parents of these children to know that I am pleased that they asked me to help here this evening, and I want to thank all of you for helping as well. I wasn't riding around in a limo looking for somebody to help, but this has been one of the few events in my life that I did enjoy and I didn't bitch about. Thank you all very much.
Before we go, just one final word. First of all, bottom of the fifth, Atlanta 5, New York 2. Don Imus, thank you. There is one simple truth tonight. Because of you, millions of children are going to have a better life. Whether it's your Center for Sudden Infant Death Syndrome, your research for cancer victims, your ranch for children, your presence here tonight for spina bifida. We will always remember your very big heart for saving kids who, through no fault of their own, just need a little love, a little respect, and a little help, and that's what you gave them tonight, and we thank you. And as we leave tonight, let us celebrate the hope and optimism of the evening by remembering the real reason we are here, Al and Judy, and for their devotion and dedication as parents. And let us all stop by table 17 on our way out and say hello and pat on the back and give a big smile and salute the bravest young man I have ever known, the inspirational, the indomitable, my friend Jeffrey Woodruff Hunt. Thank you and good night.
Just ahead here on C-SPAN, American Perspectives continues with former Democratic Party fundraiser Johnny Chung. He talks about the campaign fundraising investigation's effect on his life. Then at 10:40 Eastern, Kay James on the goals of the conservative movement. And at 11, another chance to see the Don Imus charity roast. Right now on our companion network, C-SPAN 2, we're in the middle of 48 hours of programming about the world of nonfiction books on Book TV. Sunday's lineup includes programs from the Southern Festival of Books in Nashville, Tennessee. Authors include Victoria Radford, Fred Hobson, and Ronald Kessler. That's Sunday from 2 to 6 Eastern, and then again from 8 to midnight Eastern on C-SPAN 2's Book TV. Sunday night on Book Notes, Author Patrick Tyler joins us to discuss his book, A Great Wall, Six Presidents and China, an Investigative History. And you can see it at 8 p.m. Eastern and Pacific here on C-SPAN. C-SPAN. Created in 1979 by America's cable television companies. Now, American Perspective continues with Johnny Chung. The former fundraiser for the Democratic Party spoke last week at a conference hosted by Judicial Watch. He talked about the campaign finance investigation and how it's affected his life. His remarks run about an hour.
I think a matter of courage is given to the soldier who died for the country in the battlefield, or the firefighter who saved somebody's life, or the policeman who saved a citizen in the street. But for someone who just simply come out and tell the truth in political field, and you can get a medal of honor, a medal of courage. Thank you. I really take this one with the full honor. But the real recipient should be my wife and my daughter. I'm here tonight. My pastor is here. My wife is here. And my daughter is here. I always tell the truth. And you bet you, I'm going to tell the truth once more and in front of them.
Do you still have the sight, Vernon? Are they together?
Yes.
You warned me of this all those years ago. What must I do now? Kill them?
I can tell you nothing more. My days are ended. The gods of once are gone forever. It's a time for men. It's your time, Arthur.
I need you now, more than ever.
No. This is the moment that you must face at last, to be king alone.
And you, old friend? Will I see you again?
No. There are other worlds. This one is done with me.
Excalibur will continue in a moment on A&E.
When what you eat and drink upsets your stomach, you want a medicine that works directly on your stomach. Pepto-Bismol. As it coats, Pepto delivers powerful medicine right where you hurt. Pepto-Bismol.
Cheddar cheese. It turns tortilla chips into hot, delicious
nachos.
But take away the cheddar.
Hey, bring that back.
And you're stuck with plain tortilla chips.
No way, Jose.
So pile on the cheddar.
All right.
Because tasty cheddar makes everything better.
Dad, before you read my report card, let me explain.
Just undo it.
there seems to be a problem with your checking account.
Just undo it.
Traffic is backed up for 2 miles on...
Just undo it. At the end of the day, just step into your own private spa and just undo it. To learn more, call 1-800-323-3996.
Politicians think we're more powerful than they are. Why not use it?
Built on a foundation of corruption and absolute control.
If that's what brings down governments, have we got it?
A global media empire.
I get the network, but it's not conditional.
Where influence had a price.
They're only trying to buy respect.
And greed dictated truth.
I've been accused of abusing my power.
The power of the press.
Now it's impossible to stop.
Was the power of one man, the Paper Man. An A&E premiere movie, next Saturday.
Behind this umbrella stands an independent agent representing the Travelers, your partner in insurance protection, providing you with insurance and investment expertise and a commitment to customer service, meeting your individual and business needs with a customized package of products and services, open in case you want the team that delivers. The Travelers and its independent agents. You're better off under the umbrella.
Bifocals. I'm gonna look just like my father. My grandfather. Wait, nobody'll notice the lines if I do some cool frames. Or something. This is not working.
For those who refuse to be seen in bifocals, we offer the perfect disguise. Verilux No-Line Bifocals. The vision you need, the look you want, none of the lines. Call for a Verilux professional near you.
Honey, I wonder if you could tell me where this is.
Oh, dancing and music. It's definitely a party town.
Is it Rio?
Oh, yes, Brazil.
No. Look, this is a place for excitement, adventure.
Yes, a nature, wilderness.
Is there a jungle?
Yes.
The easiest part of getting a home, realestate.com. The way it's meant to be.
If only business could move fluidly ahead without interruptions. It can. Windstar gives you the opportunity to overcome business obstacles with seamless communications and technology. Windstar. Brave new business.
I like to live big. I like big surprises. Big dreams.
Introducing the innovative new GE Spectrum.
Big healthy babies.
It's so big, it holds a turkey, 2 casseroles, and 3 loaves of bread.
I like to entertain, big time.
Or 288 hors d'oeuvres, or 12 perfect pies.
I love having a whole house full of people.
GE Spectrum, the biggest, most accurate oven in America. It cooks big inside and out.
Most of all, I like the big smiles that I get when I cook big.
Cook big with the incredible new GE Spectrum.
Big.
Everybody take your seats. Okay, class, let's try some basic phrases. Repeat after me. Katrina. Does this bus go downtown? Okay, maybe not. Bill, how many stops to Wall Street?
Ah, the stock market!
I'm praying for a rally, you know.
What is the story with cyclicals?
Cyclicals?
Schmicklicals.
Cyclical, schmicklical.
On a merry trade.
You play with a merry trade?
I tried with a merry trade.
I live for a merry trade.
All right. Okay, class, what is this Ameritrade?
You trade stocks on your computer.
One trade, $8.
Log on Ameritrade.
Yeah. Log on.
So how do I pick a stock?
You do the research.
It's free.
Free?
It means no charge. Pro bono.
Ameritrade is a great and wonderful thing.
And they said capitalism would never work.
Call toll-free 1-888-590-8009. Ameritrade. Believe in yourself.
Look, Paul. You know, I value your advice and everything. But give me just one good reason why I should say anything nice about Don Imus.
I give you 10 million. He's got 10 million listeners, and a ton of them in the New York primary.
Really?
Former mayor of New York City, David Dinkins, has said essentially the same thing.
Yep.
As have other leading prominent black people.
Mm-hmm.
So Bernard is in Manhattan at 3rd Avenue and 88th Street with Stefan Tweck and Monteria Ivy, co-authors of the book Snaps. They also got a movie coming out. Let's go to Bernard now. Good morning, Bernard.
Good morning, Mr. Imus. How's the I-Man doing this morning?
You don't worry about how I'm doing. How are you doing?
Well, we're doing fine, Imus. Mr. Imus, we just found actually the only cab driver in Manhattan who does not wear a turban or where the taxi doesn't smell like a WNBA locker room. And we're going to ask him why he can't, perhaps. By the way, Kwesi Mfume by a vowel. And that was a shameless attempt to jump on the bandwagon with Danny Glover. Don't you think, Mr. Imus?
I don't know, Bernard. Just, you know.
Gino, tell me, what's the problem with picking up black male?
I have no problem at all. I pick everybody up, you know. And especially late early in the morning, everybody wants to get home from work. So, I don't have a problem with that. I pick everybody up and take them where they want to go. I just came from Crown Heights at 4:30 this morning.
So what do you think? Do you think Danny Glover's lying, or what happened? Why do you think people don't want to pick up black males?
I find that hard to believe, especially at 5 o'clock in the evening. I mean, it's still light out, you know.
By the way, we're going to get out now and see if Stefan Zweig and Monteri Ivan can catch a taxi. Listen. But this gentleman once took Mr. Imus home from a Hurley's bar to Greenwich, Connecticut, and he got stiffed. Is that right, Gino?
That's true. And also, hey, Imus, without Bernard and Fred, man, you in trouble. Take care of these guys.
Gino, my man, hit him in the muscle. Gino must feel like a stranger down at the taxi stand. It's like a mosque, and he's the only white guy. So Stefan Zweig and Monteri are going to head down there right now.
Yeah, like right here, stop for us.
We don't want the taxi to pick them up, so we want you guys to sort of affect the, yo, taxi, yo, we don't want to pick you up, so head on down here right now, Jim. What do you think?
All right. I don't know about what this guy's talking about. You know what? Because he tried to pass us by, Mr. Imus. Yeah, but you pick up Jim Jensen, wouldn't you? But he's dead. You pick up Joe DiMaggio. He's dead, too. Or you pick up Ronald Reagan. He should be dead.
You know, we really wanted some intimidating Black Panther types, and we got a couple of black pantyways, but we're going to do our best with these two guys. Head on down here, gentlemen, and see if he can pick it up. And I'm going to go out in the street and see if they pick up a nice little altar boy like myself.
Yeah.
Hey, that's my taxi, lady. Where you going?
Pick up Elvis.
Go ahead, gentlemen. Get out there.
I wish you would pass
okay.
me by.
Okay, here come the taxis up the block, as you can hopefully see on TV.
Yeah.
The cameraman's coming around here. Good luck, Gino. Take it easy. Imus will send you a check. Sure he will. See ya. So long. Okay, here we go. Now, it looks like they're actually getting a taxi. Look, here we go. He passed them by. Right here. He passed right by. Hey, look at this.
Oh, I can't believe he passed me by.
What's up with you, man? What's your name?
Tariq.
Hey, Tariq, man. Why didn't you pick up my brothers from another mother? My fugly brothers from another mother over here.
Hey.
Oh, you saw me before you saw the brothers? They're invisible. Sonny, James Ellison wrote a book, The Invisible Man.
Watch, I'm you hitting me.
Why? Because are you afraid of black males? You think they're going to rob you?
No.
Oh, yes.
Keep it real, Habib. Come on now. Why? You don't want to take them to Harlem? What's the problem?
Hey, so why'd you pass us? You bum. You piece of rectal tissue. Your mother smokes crack with George W. Bush.
Bernard McGurk, Stefan Zweig, and Monteri Ivan. And, well, for the first cab drove by.
Yeah.
So.
You say you want a revolution. Well, you know.
In the morning.
I got a first cab
go for him. What do you want to do with David Bloom?
Just because you're stuck at work doesn't mean you can't be in the game. Log on to MSNBCSports.com for the latest scores, stats, and schedules from NBC Sports. Plus, ask the pros and sports chat 24 hours a day. Hey, it's a slam dunk. Log on and work smarter with MSNBCSports.com. Newswire, plugged in to the day's top stories with in-depth analysis and live coverage from NBC News. Newswire with Greg Jarrett, today noon Eastern on MSNBC.
Mom, did that file open yet?
No.
Buy a Gateway PC with the YourWare program and you can trade it in toward the purchase of a new one in 2 years.
Mom!
You'll never
ever have old computer. Call now. Get a Gateway PC with an Intel Pentium 3 processor and a printer for $38 a month.
I'm a mall Santa, and it's a little slow this year, but I have prospects.
Get a watch today here, Santa Wise.
Hey, where are you going? Hey, hey!
You can't dwell on what was, really.
We were the kings. Don't forget that, okay?
I don't blame the malls. It's not their fault people don't shop there.
Skip the mall. Go to shopnow.com. It's the shortest distance between you and the stuff you want.
I wake up every morning, I look at myself in the mirror, and I go, it's a good day to be Santa.
You want to take charge of your financial future, but you're still sitting on that proverbial fence. This will help you get off it. The E-Trade Online Investing Kit. It shows you how to invest in stocks from $4.95 with rebate, plus bonds and options. How E-Trade exclusives like Smart Alerts keep tabs on your investments, and how PowerSearch quickly evaluates thousands of mutual funds. Call 1-800-387-2402 now, and you'll get $75 as an E-Trade sign-up bonus. E-Trade also provides late-breaking news and analysis so you can make more informed decisions. No wonder E-Trade is the number one place to invest online. Call 1-800-387-2402 now, and you'll get $75 as an E-Trade sign-up bonus. Consider it a little something extra to get you off the fence. It's time for E-Trade, the number one place to invest online.
www. Search engines. Click here, click there. Take the kids to practice. E-banking, e-tickets, e-stocks. Send mom flowers. Link to this, link to that. You have mail. Where's your file? Where's your life?
Looking for an easier way to make smarter decisions? Don't get tangled up in a web of useless information. Surf less, net more. Click this. YouDecide.com gives you better deals on cards, insurance, buying a home, financial plans, health, all kinds of smarter ways to manage your money and your life. You get the facts you need. You figure out what's best for you. Then, you decide. Need help with your decision? You're not alone. Our consumer advisors are just a click away. And they're not on commission, so you'll get the straight story anytime, day or night. And YouDecide.com is absolutely free. So don't go crazy untangling the web. Click this. Go crazy saving time and money. Surf less, net more. Go to youdecide.com.
Bob Curtis in Nebraska is a Democrat, and he's been on the program about 100 times, and he's on again.
Yep.
Good morning, Senator Kerry.
Morning, Don.
How are you?
Good.
How about them sandbagging poor old George Bush yesterday?
Yeah, geez, I'm glad they didn't ask me.
Yeah, I mean, how would anybody know that stuff?
I'm glad that he knew one of them. I think I could have gotten. I know I could have gotten India and Taiwan, and I sort of knew the guy in Pakistan, but Chechnya I would have lost.
Well, I think that one of their spokesmen said he was running for president, not to we didn't want to be a contestant on Jeopardy. So.
Yeah.
Who are you supporting for the presidency, by the way?
Bradley.
Oh, you are.
Yeah.
Oh, man, that's great news, isn't it, Charles?
Well, yeah.
Well, Charles and I are trying to figure out a way to funnel money to this guy, but we don't give money to political candidates.
We don't do funneling anymore.
That's
a bad verb.
That's what Senator Bradley informed me yesterday, by the way, or whenever he was on, that he was he would refuse any money from us. So why are you supporting him?
I think he's an authentic guy. I like the way he makes decisions, not afraid to decide, something if it is adverse to the audience, and I think he's a guy who will be a great president. I like the way he surrounds himself with talented people and listens to all points of view, and yet he's still a Democrat. He's still advocating universal health care. He's still concerned about the poor. He gave a great I loved his speech in Crystal City, where he said the economy is booming, and that's terrific. He voted for the budget in 93. He's pleased with the progress he made, but the things that we value most of our families, our kids, our schools, our health care system are doing very well.
Yeah. He's got a health care plan that the vice president, who, by the way, is going to be on this program on Tuesday, that the vice president says, and others say, his health care plan would bankrupt the country. So.
Well, I think the Democratic Party is bankrupt if universal health insurance is a bad idea. I mean, I'm not... this Naomi Wolf flap doesn't bother me at all. We all do nutty things like You know, I tried to change the color of my hair and ended up having to choose publicly between premature orange and premature gray. So I'm not worried about that, although I see in the Times this morning she didn't do anything for $15,000 a month. I'm much more concerned about attack on health care. I don't want our party to become a party that says that universal health insurance is a bankrupt and bad idea. I mean, I think we've not got much if that's what this primary becomes.
Actually, the point, though, is, and I think it's probably well taken, is that these proposals that these candidates make are just that. I mean, once they get in office, I mean, at least they have they're headed in the right direction and they have a good idea, so I hear what you're saying.
Yeah, but, you know, there is something wrong when you've got an $8.8 trillion economy in the wealthiest nation on earth, and we get 40 million Americans who out there in the workforce that don't have health insurance. And it affects their lives. It affects their ability to live free. And I know that personally because I got universal health care because I got blown up in a war. All Bradley's saying is he wants to lower the threshold a little bit.
I remember when you remember, I don't know whether you revealed it on this program or, but we know, I saw you someplace when you stopped putting that stuff in your hair. And I didn't recognize you.
Well, you know, about sitting there saying, "Geez, I don't like the way I look," and so, but the coloring made me look orange. So, you know, I don't know. That was I chose gray over orange.
I don't want you to take this the wrong way, but you're a good-looking guy. I don't think you need to do anything here, did you?
It's hard not to take it the wrong way.
Well, yeah, I don't understand that. we're talking with Senator Bob Kerr from Nebraska, who we tried to get to run for president, and you were thinking about it, weren't you? But
I did give it some thought, yeah.
Why did you decide not to?
You got to want it. I just didn't want it. I didn't, you know, I don't want to be president strong enough to do it. You know, it's sort of, you can get it in your head, you know, that'd be nice to be president, but I choose the Senate. I'm enjoying that work.
So some people think that Al Gore doesn't really want to be president. I mean, that, you know, he's just kind of sort of a, like Dilbert said, a kind of a victim of life circumstances, mm-hmm. and got positioned so that he doesn't have much choice. I mean, he kind of has to go through with it, you know. But
I think that's not probably right.
Really?
He certainly looks to me like he wants to get the job done. Yeah, I think, you know, anybody that has been as close to it as he has knows both the positives and the negatives. He's seen... Mm-hmm. You know, the president's basically a prisoner in the White House, so he knows that and understands that, and he knows the price that he's going to have to pay if he's successful.
Because I think if he wanted to establish that he had severed any sort of relationship with the president, appearing on this program will pretty much do that. he'll have less access to the White House than Monica Lewinsky does. He'll be out here banging on the gates trying to get in. We're going to have a budget deal here? I guess we are. Huh?
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, there's five bills that'll get rolled into one omnibus bill, and we're going to end. I mean, the trouble is we're going to end up busting clear past the caps that we imposed to the balanced budget agreement in '97, and we still have not honestly addressed the two big problems, and one's Social Security, and one's Medicare. And for some reason, we think the greatest generation in the history of this country, Americans who are over the age of 65, can't take the truth. And I think they can, but for political reasons, we just aren't going to do either one.
So that's what it really has been, just politics.
Yeah, I mean, the problem we've got with our budget is that more and more of that budget is going for mandatory programs. And the two big ones are Social Security and Medicare, and the next one's Medicaid, long-term care Medicaid. And we're not even debating. That's two-thirds of the budget. Two-thirds of the budget is mandatory. A third of it is discretionary, and that's what we've been arguing about. And the discretionary piece is getting smaller and smaller. And the net effect is... we're spending more and more on people over 65 and less on people under age 18. While our mouths are talking about our kids, we're spending less of our income on them and more on ourselves. And, you know, hell, eventually they figure it out.
There was a guy shot seven people in Honolulu the other day, and another shooting in Seattle, I believe, yesterday. And my question for you is, and I think Charlton Heston and some other people at the NRA were testifying Capitol Hill yesterday. My question for you is, would gun control have made any, or more stiffer gun control laws, or what would have made a difference in this, do you think?
I don't know if in these two cases it'd make a difference, but I find it appalling that we can't pass a juvenile justice bill because there's a provision in the bill that says that gun shows should be regulated the same way as licensed gun dealers. You know, we have a law on the books right now that says if you're a gun dealer, and there's only about 300 of 16,000 gun dealers that are a problem, I mean, there are studies that show that, but the law says you can only go in and inspect that gun shop once a year, and if the person destroys their records, they can only be charged with a misdemeanor. That's federal law. That's what You know, that's how powerful the National Rifle Association has been. They've been able to weaken the gun laws. So, you know, there's more regulation of you if you're running a pawn shop than if you're running a gun show. A show. So, I mean, I don't know whether it would have stopped the Hawaiian thing or the deal in Seattle. But there's no question that our gun laws have substantial loopholes in it, and it's too darn easy to buy guns.
But the NRA says, and others, that if we just enforce the gun laws that we have, and there are, well, you know, there are hundreds of them that don't get enforced.
I don't disagree with that. I don't disagree that our gun laws can be enforced more, but I don't think they can deny that if you're, you know, if I have a bar, and I've got bars in Nebraska, the liquor license guys can come out any time they want and inspect my bar and ask for my books and find out whether or not I'm serving underage people, and they ought to. I don't begrudge that. But if I have a gun show, they can't come out and inspect it. Or if my licensed gun dealer, under federal law, they can only come out and inspect me once to find out whether or not I'm selling guns to people that shouldn't have guns. Now that says the law's too darn weak. They object to a background check of 3 days in a gun show. They're willing to go a day, but a day doesn't get the bad guys. 24 hours just gets the good guys. You need at least 72 hours to be able to do a background check to find out whether the person buying the gun has mental instability or problems in the past that would indicate that he's at risk. And the NRA is opposed to that. So I do find it appalling that it's still altogether too easy to buy a gun in America.
I used to think that running background checks on people was fairly simple until we started checking people going to work this ranch. It takes forever, and it costs a fortune to do a background check on somebody.
Hey, I'm glad it is a little bit hard to do a background check. I mean, I still want a little bit of privacy.
Well,
you know, I don't mind. You know, background checks when I'm doing it on somebody else, it frustrates me. It takes so long. But when somebody's doing a background check on me, I'm glad it takes them forever.
Yeah, but we want to know. I mean, it should be easy to find out if somebody's been fooling around with some kid or something, you know.
Well, that's true.
Or dyeing their hair.
No, that part's easy to figure out.
Have you been in on this Carol Moseley Braun deal, or what's that?
Yeah, I certainly know what's going on.
What do you think?
Well, I think that, you know, what do I think? I think the chairman should be sitting down with Moseley Braun and working it out so we can get a hearing on her and get her confirmed. I mean, they had an argument over the Confederate flag, and you know, if I'm nominated, when Bill Weld was nominated to be ambassador of Mexico, and he said, well, the chairman is angry at me because I said I wouldn't vote for him, it's up to Weld to go talk to the chairman and mend the fence. If I say something that offends, if you're the chairman of a committee and I say something that offends you, I got to go talk to Don Imus, the chairman Imus, to work it out. So I hope that Carol's gone and talked to Chairman Helms, and because I think they can work it out. If they don't. If she goes and talks to him, I don't think she needs to apologize. That's a little silly. But I think it would be wrong for Senator Helms to say, I'm going to hold her up because she and I had a conflict when we were in the Senate.
He's nuts, though, isn't he?
No, I don't think Jesse Helms is nuts at all. No.
Probably great if I could get you to say that.
No. You and I are a little nuts.
Did you say anything? Well, is she qualified to be the ambassador to New Zealand?
I mean, Shirley Temple Black was an ambassador. I mean, what do you got to do to be ambassador? Show up to cocktail parties.
So you think she is, then?
Yes.
Oh, okay. See anything in these off-year elections that means anything to you?
No.
Yeah.
No, except my friend Lou Puller's wife won in Virginia. That's the only thing I was paying attention to.
Something you care about, right? When do you run again?
In November 2000.
And you're going to run, I guess?
Uh-huh.
And how's your personal situation? I know we're not supposed to ask stuff like this.
Yeah, it's okay.
Oh, it is?
Yeah.
So you've still got the same babe and all that?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Life is good.
Because we were trying to fix you up. Who were we trying to fix you up? Maureen Dowd.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's right.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. But then you got all huffy about it or something.
Well, can you imagine? If that didn't go well, I wouldn't like the columns that were written.
Man, that would be a nightmare,
yeah,
wouldn't it?
Yeah, think about that.
So it's nice to have you in the program, Senator Kerry. Thank you very much.
I appreciate it.
Senator Bob Kerry from Nebraska, yeah, here on the I'm Swearing program. It's 21 until the hour. You don't like my jacket, Bernard?
You become a caricature of yourself.
Well,
you really. It's
Bernard
just ridiculous.
Is absolutely right.
It's New York City, and you're walking around with Jerry Spence jackets and cowboy hats.
And cowboys, and particularly with a cowboy hat. My wife tells me I look adorable.
You guys going line dancing tonight?
See, that's where you don't get it, Bernie. It's not about building a bridge to the future. It's about building a tribe. And you're supposed to be part of...
Oh, for God.
Oh, God almighty. Oh,
honey,
are you smoking those mushrooms?
You need the buckskin on that bald head. That's what you
honey, you leave Bernie alone.
You know what?
Feathers hanging off
you leave Bernie alone.
You do a pretty good Jennifer Capriati impression. Where'd you learn how to do that?
It was fun.
If your radio sounds funny in the morning, you're listening to Imus in the Morning.
Honey?
Yeah?
Why don't you tell them about the John Smith Pocahontas little game we play?
A little Indian game, eh? That's cute.
No, we don't play any kind of thing.
I'm smoking a little peace pipe. Yeah.
I'm in the morning.
Nikon has decided to celebrate the millennium a little early this year. This coming up Monday, the award-winning Nikon Coolpix 950 camera, considered one of the most successful digital cameras of all time, offering 2.11 megapixels of resolution. This is easy to use as a point-and-shoot. Actually, I have one of the numbered limited edition cameras right here in the studio with me. Nikon going to celebrate the millennium with a special one-time sale of this limited edition Millennium Coolpix 950 digital camera, with the profits from the camera going to the Imus Ranch for Kids with Cancer. Beginning November 8th at 9 a.m. Eastern Time, Nikon will be offering this special Millennium Coolpix 950 limited edition camera only on their website store at NikonOutlet.com. Only 2,000 cameras will be sold for the price of $2,000. The collector's edition will be numbered and will include...
A loyal employee held hostage in a foreign country. See how his boss made the ultimate sacrifice that saved his life. Plus, his talk show's a hit, but this host wasn't always on top. The Fall and Rise of Regis Philbin. The stories that keep you talking, watch Special Edition.
Tonight at 8 on MSNBC.
In the last 13 years, Nicorette helped over a million people help themselves stop smoking. And that was the reason that convinced me to use Nicorette. All these people knew it was safe and effective. Nicorette delivers a low level of nicotine fast to help control cravings without the tars and toxins found in cigarettes. And Nicorette was proven safe and effective in more clinical trials than any other product. Just the idea that Nicorette had helped all those people made me feel that Nicorette was the right choice for me in the end. Which it was.
Nicorette helps you fight your cravings, your habit, your way. You can do it. Nicorette can help.
At home, I'm a mom. At work, I'm part of the technology group at International Paper. One of our customers is a bike company who came to us because their bikes were getting banged up in shipping. So we invented a new type of box that helps keep their bikes protected. The bike I ordered for Kristen arrived without a scratch. Perfect and clean.
Thanks, Mom. Cuddles!
How can we help with your shipping needs? International Paper. From innovation to results.
Are you concerned about losing more hair? Do you wonder how much further it will go? Do you wish you could do something about it? Well, there's a pill for men with certain types of hair loss. It's called Propecia. In clinical studies, the vast majority of men, 83%, maintain their current hair count, and most, 66%, regrew some hair. Take it daily and you could see results in as little as 3 months. Propecia is for men only. A small number of men experience certain sexual side effects. Each occurred in less than 2% of men. Women who are or may potentially be pregnant must not use it or handle broken tablets because of the risk of a specific kind of birth defect. Talk to your doctor or pharmacist and read the consumer information they can provide. For a free brochure on Propecia, call toll-free 1-888-2-MERC-4. It will give you more facts and show you clinical before and after photos. You can also receive a list of doctors in your area. Propecia, helping make hair loss history.